Good evening and welcome to the Deerfield Selectboard Board of Health meeting for February 26, 2020. We're starting the meeting at 5 p.m. this evening at the main meeting room, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass. So this meeting will be recorded. If you have comments, please come and speak to a mic clearly. We're starting off the meeting with scheduling some hearings with Christina Johnson, the Senior Center Director and Coordinator, and then Kevin Scarborough for the Superintendent of Public Works to go over their budgets. So we'll get started with Christina. Come on up. How are you?
Thank you.
Hi.
Yeah, thanks for coming. How are you?
Of course. Good. How are you?
Good. So I don't know if anyone has had a chance to go over the budget yet, but I could run down it, and since I'm on the boo, I could go over it, and you could hit some notes, too. This shouldn't take too long, but this budget is split into three sections. As you see, you'll have a senior center expense, which is kind of the figure of as a general fund for the senior center. And then there is a formula grant, which we get from every kind of, the state gives us some money for every, you know, senior in town, and that kind of $12 maybe a senior.
Yes.
Kind of gets compiled, and then that goes into another fund, and we use that money specifically. And then there is a what's called a SIG grant fund, which is for our outreach coordinator. We've been lucky enough to get that grant for the last few years, and that does pay for one person to do some outreach to reach our seniors in their home that can't get to the senior center and do some other work as well. So super important. And I think we just learned we did get the grant again this year,
I
know it's a little more than we were budgeting, but we're a little nervous because they're looking at maybe cutting the other grants too. So
correct.
We're gonna keep that budget where it's
so
at.
Those numbers, it's possible they will change the two grant numbers.
Yes.
It's possible they will actually change.
Mm-hmm. So everyone out there, call your legislatures.
Yes,
and
exactly.
Support your seniors, please.
They're discussing it in Boston right now.
Yep. So I'll go over the main, you know, again, the kind of the general fund budget, which is we changed a couple years ago how we allocated our money, and if you look over the last few years, you'll see some larger increases, but it really had to do with really getting a hold of the cost that it takes to run that center as far as maintenance. Funding our director to have insurance, which was a huge part that wasn't funded because at one time one employee didn't need it, so that was a larger increase as well. But we really kind of focused on using our appropriations from the town to fund our staff, and then try to use, you know, some money that we get from the state to run programs. So that way that we weren't kind of shortchanging things. If the grant kind of fell off a bit, we weren't stuck not having money for our director. So we kind of, with Diane Cornwall's help, we re-engineered how the budget worked a couple years ago, and so here we are. So we're looking to move this the director to finally a 40-hour position. We've been kind of creeping that up as she's taken on more and more of the position and the responsibilities there, and there's a lot. I mean, you're there 60 hours a week.
Right.
I see your car all the time, but we're paying you for where you are. So we have the needs, and we're hoping that, you know, again, we always ask that you try to push out to the other towns and do more functions in
right.
Sunderland, in Waitley.
Yep.
So we have more reach across the area and more seniors using it. So some of a lot of this stays the same. So really one of the jumps is the directors to move from, I think it was 36 to 40
yes,
hours.
Correct.
And then with that, obviously your retirement and things go up a bit because of everybody moves a step and all, and then these increase 4 hours
mm-hmm.
A week. That raises that a bit. But most everything else is you know, we're not using, postage is $100. And if you'll notice, a lot of these, if anyone ever looks at this, a lot of these, postage, you know, we put in the formula grant. We have some of it in the general fund, like $100, but most of the postage, $1,500, is in the formula grant. So, and none of it is in the SIG grant
right.
for the outreach grant. So it's a little complicated to follow, but mainly the changes that we were making with this the largest change was that we added a line of $5,500 for transportation. And transportation is a, and that's a huge chunk of money that we're asking in the budget, but it is such an important part of reaching our seniors and giving services to them and getting you know, hopefully getting them to functions or getting them to the senior center. We've been trying to work really hard for the last year or so to figure out how to tackle the transportation problem.
Yes.
And it's, we have Franklin County Regional Transportation, then and that serves Waitley and Deerfield, but it doesn't serve Sunderland.
Right.
And so when you have a function going, like some people can get on the bus and some people can't get on the bus, and it's really,
right.
it's complicated and more than it needs to be. But talking with Berniston and the way they do their program, and I want to gear towards that, is that they fund about $55,000 a year, the two towns, I think Berniston and Northfield. And at the end of the year, they get a reimbursement back from FRTA for that
right.
amount of money. And they use that, and they have their own driver, and they schedule trips, and that person coordinates all the dispatching, and it seems to work out pretty well. And I thought at first we were going to put this $5,500 in here to get like four trips maybe to a show or something during the year, but we were all like, four trips? You know, it's a lot of money when you get, and seniors are still paying into that too to take a trip. So we're thinking, I would like to use this as leverage with the FRTA or PVMA to do more of a PVTA to do more of a you know, kind of offset some of the cost to get a bus and a driver. So hoping to use that money for leverage
right.
instead of just trips. So we had it originally in the budget for a couple of trips, but we think we might be able to use it more effectively and get more out of it by negotiating with the
Yeah, I'm hopefully maybe some combination that we can
right.
still do some trips, which I'm asked about almost every day.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, people want that. There's a great need for that. So.
Yeah. And then use it for the other part to negotiate so that we have, you know, seniors can get to our center, or
right.
if we're going on a trip, we can, you know.
I think the key to it, it seems like what's key to Berniston's success is that they have two or three responsible drivers.
Right.
And the drivers make sure everybody, you know, people call in and they're familiar enough with the seniors that are calling in so they know how, where they're going, what their home situation is, so that they can accommodate. I mean, some are a little bit slower than others getting out the door and need a little help. And, you know, there is this huge commitment by the driver. So if we could, I think it's a really good way to spend our money if we could make sure we need to recruit good drivers.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's really what the key is. And they're younger, what they are is younger elders.
Yeah.
And, you know, early 60 elders versus,
right.
you know, elder elders. And so that is so helpful.
And certainly in this budget, we don't have the money to do that.
But it's the beginning start to negotiate that.
No,
that $5,500 is all they do. It's rotated out through two or three people.
Yeah.
But that's what they do.
Well, they budget $55,000.
I thought it was $5,500 per person.
No.
It's not? Oh,
man. At least not. That's what she said. She budgets $55,000. She gets it back at the end of the year.
Right.
So they take over. So they have not only... Okay, so the drivers... It is their drivers. It's
mm-hmm.
not PVM.
Correct.
You know, it's not FRTA.
Exactly.
Because that's what I
drivers.
Think is what's hugely important is the responsible, good
mm-hmm.
drivers.
And they
and
handle
then,
all the dispatching at the
right.
senior center.
So they're actually covering the vans? Because
mm-hmm.
I thought they got the vans on grant.
I think we want to negotiate a bit and talk
right.
with, so we're going to talk with Bob Decker because he's our rep on the FRTA.
Okay. Okay.
I've started that conversation.
Maybe I misunderstood.
And maybe I am too. So.
Does this all have to be routed through like FRTA or PVTA?
Yes.
Versus even private?
Yes, because you know, private's really expensive and you don't get any state grant money back.
The key is to get the reimbursement through, because a lot of the trips are to doctors,
mm-hmm.
and some of them are like, I mean, they have a bus that takes, you know, on, they try to schedule like Tuesdays and Fridays to go to Springfield. And see, that's my huge concern, is that with all the specialists moving from our area down to Springfield, you have less and less ability of seniors to drive seniors. Yes. And family, family members or friends have to take whole days off of work because it's such a, you know, it's much more of a longer trip than just running into Greenfield.
I constantly, almost every day, get calls from family members out there wondering what we can do for them. And unfortunately, there's really not much currently that we can. And I hate having to say that every time.
Right.
When Trevor and I visited, that was up in Berniston, and when Emmett was there just on yesterday.
Yep.
And he, because you went, I
yes.
think.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yes, thank you for doing that.
Thank you very much. And so when I talked to him later, he said make sure the most important thing was to count all our seniors.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
absolutely.
And because this, we can show from what has happened in our community from 2010 to 2020,
right.
and what the projection is, you know, for 30 and 40, and so based on that, we can have a really good, story to tell
right.
as why we need the support to get this going.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So that's kind of, you know, I know it's a big ask, but that's kind of what we had started to use that as leverage to try and jumpstart this.
Yeah,
this
starting point to solve this.
Yeah.
So I think everything else is, you know, pretty straightforward. Again, some of these are in the general fund or also split over to the formula fund grant. Different programs that we use, the conference fee and different miscellaneous program cost and dues and that kind of thing. Exercise programs are we're using the grant that we get, the formula fund grant for that, and then the outreach is really just goes to it's really just to her salary for it's a very only have a few hours because that's all we can get, and then some outreach programming that she does with that. So that's kind of where we're at on that. I don't know if anyone has any questions about it, but
can the total annual budget for the senior center is
so the total for all three towns, if I have this right, is I have this right at 94,681, and then Sunderland pays 25%, Waitley pays 25%, Deerfield pays 25%. So we're
50%.
Excuse me, 50%. So we're about 47,000 to the town, 47,341.
Right. Yes.
Which, you know, in this scheme of things, it's not enough money for all the things that our seniors need. That's what we can afford at the moment.
Right.
Until we can start leveraging other grants and all. So.
Christine, if you had your druthers, what would you like us to support to enhance your programs and what you want to do in the senior center?
Transportation would be number one.
The biggest one?
Yeah,
okay.
Getting vans, getting drivers.
Okay.
However that ends up looking, whether it's the grants or we're getting reimbursed, but bottom line, yeah, we need a van, we need drivers.
Yeah.
That's number one.
Yeah.
Much. And then along with that, we're all working on space for our seniors,
right.
which it's a mess, and that's like really...
Yeah, we're working on that.
Yes.
We're trying to do a lot of other ways to kind of make that happen. That's the bigger egg.
More space, yes.
More space.
We might have more news in another month or so.
Yeah, we're working, trying to get some.
Because there's a lot more we could be doing if we even had another room.
It's, you know, you look at everything that we have here, and it's, and I've felt this for a long time, that we just dreadfully underfund what we have to do for our seniors in this town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
And considering for the three towns, it's only less than $100,000.
Right.
It's absolutely ridiculous. We've got to figure out something quickly to, one, we've got a senior center that most people don't want to really go to.
Right.
And, you know, the transportation and just coordinating with the other two towns and just coming up with something, so.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that, as a board, and of course with the BOO, is that something should be a major focus within the next year.
Yeah.
To, you know, gotta either do something or get off the pot.
Right, yes.
Yes.
So it's,
And more and more seniors are, you know.
Yes.
The population of our seniors grow.
And it's gonna keep growing, so.
Exponentially every year.
Yeah.
And we need to address this for sure.
And how many seniors, actually individuals, show up at the center in the course of time? Do you know?
Like on a given day or, it's, believe it or not, it's always kind of hard to answer that because it does fluctuate depending on certainly what we're having, what's going on.
There could
on
be,
a day.
You know, 100 people at an event.
Yeah.
Or there could be 20 people at one, you know, at a bingo thing. Or,
right.
Know, there's so many different stuff that goes on. But we touch quite a few, and I think with a better space and transportation, a lot of seniors
yes.
can't get out of their house, and they just would love that company
right.
or just come to have lunch or something like that. We have no way to go get them.
Because there's people that used to come that now cannot drive,
yeah.
and they can't get there.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's heartbreaking because
yeah.
they want to be there and they're with their, you know, friends. And
it's just social interaction
right.
makes somebody so much more healthy than being, you know, shut in at home and maybe
yeah.
getting a visit here and there. But family are away, family are busy.
Right.
We all get busy in life and it's hard to check in. And, you know, luckily we have really dedicated people in town. You do a wonderful job. And,
you
know, Meg's doing a lot of work and Sharon Petura does wonders for our seniors and Nancy and everybody
mm-hmm.
that is at that senior center really try really hard to get, you know, reach everyone they can. We just need to do better, so.
But I do see, on the positive, I do see more and more people coming in the last, well, I've only been there about a year and a half, but
mm-hmm.
I've seen a difference. And you know, some people come once a month and then there's the people that come every day,
right.
so. That's why it's not always so easy to answer in numbers because it fluctuates how involved maybe someone is. And
I want to just say people love you, Christina.
Oh,
really, you do
thank
a wonderful
you.
Job. And it's nice to hear that feedback from the community of, you know, anytime we talk, your name comes up. People really
oh,
appreciate
thank
all you.
You
do there. And I really appreciate, you know, all the effort you put in there after hours.
And other senior centers directors know that you spend time.
Mm-hmm.
It's wonderful to hear that we have a wonderful director.
Oh,
yeah.
thank you so
from
much.
From other programs. Because
yeah.
we're trying to find out information, and it's like, oh, you really have a good person, but you're just not really funding us the way
yes.
you should. So it's like...
Yep.
And I think, you know, as a town, we're looking at a number of things that are happening in the town right now.
Right.
Between marijuana cultivation, hemp cultivation, solar electric at the dump. Those are funds that the town basically didn't have before.
Right.
And, you know, I'm a firm believer that we should earmark those funds towards different, if you want to call it enterprises funds or whatever, and just, you know, be funding things.
Absent direct, yeah,
and,
dedicated.
And not just, you know.
Dave, that's a
no,
really good
no
idea.
No offense, but, you know, it can't all go into the school.
Right.
It's got to go, you know, to the people that built this town,
mm-hmm.
so it, and you know, I think the solar project is $300,000+ in itself a year.
Yeah.
So, and that should be an enterprise fund that goes to different things that the town really needs.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So. Well, I greatly appreciate the support
yeah.
from all three of you,
mm-hmm.
so
right.
and the town.
Well,
okay.
yeah.
I haven't presented anything for Sunderland yet. I actually was checking in with them today because I haven't heard anything.
Yeah.
I want to make sure I'm not falling through the cracks there. Waitley, I met with their finance committee. They meet with everyone and then they'll let me know. So I didn't officially get one word or the other, but they're very interested. Understandably, about how much usage they're getting from their Waitley residents, which, of course, is less than Deerfield. I mean, the population is less. But we still, every day, have people from all three towns. But again, kind of like I was having trouble explaining, it's hard with numbers because it just fluctuates a lot about what we're doing and if it's someone that's coming every day versus someone that comes for the cribbage tournament once a month, you know, so.
Thank you. Want to make a motion to approve this by the select board?
I make a motion. I mean, I second that. Or I'll make the motion and then.
For Deerfield's share of $47,341.
Yes.
A second. Any further comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christina.
Thank you.
Next up would be Kevin.
I don't know where that one went. I don't know what happened to my stuff.
Come on. More the merrier.
It's okay.
How are you?
I'm well. And you?
Good, good. And I think we're, if I have this right, we're going through one at a time here. I've got a packet. Is it, will you snow and ice first? Is that right?
Okay. Yeah.
Do you have a packet? Did I have a packet?
Yeah, if we could.
Yeah, it should be.
We kind of went and looked at the packets this afternoon.
All I have is the totals.
You had, oh, I was going to say, this, yeah, should be in your packet.
It was sitting right here, Carol.
Seriously?
I'm dead serious because okay. I made sure I got printed.
Yeah.
Well, I have this.
Carolyn, in your budget binder, you should have.
I have
snow
highway.
And ice, street lighting.
I have highway.
And.
Yeah. I have.
Some things, but some things have changed.
Never mind. I found it. I was looking for my vector.
So basically, when I talked with Casey earlier, you know, historically she put these things down by account number.
Yep.
I made a slight recommendation of let's try and get the ones out of the way that are, there's not much you can do about.
Snow and ice.
Snow and ice, you know. And then that way we can move forward. That way at the end you've got a little bit more time to be able to deal with the last three.
Yep, that's fine. So first is snow and ice, $423,5400. Every year, well, since 2019, we've been doing $90,000 a year, and I think we're in good shape this year as far as I know, but you never, you know.
So far.
We're almost.
Yeah, we're okay, you know. Stuff, unfortunately, a lot of people think that, you know, well, you know, we're, it's no big deal because we haven't had a whole lot of snow.
It doesn't matter.
Realistically, for the amount of rain and then cold that we've had, I've been putting down just about as much, if not more, salt.
Right.
Because unfortunately, I get the call from the police department.
It's icy.
And it's slippery. It's icy. I got to go out. I got to respond. I can't take that responsibility.
I know. I've seen an article about that this year, too, that everyone thinks that, well, we've had a really easy winter. But
right. No,
it's even just the 2 inches are just as bad.
Exactly. I mean, realistically, for me, you know, if I get 3 inches of snow, I might as well get 6 or 10. It makes no difference to me. It's the same amount of time.
Right.
The only thing that makes a little bit different is our cleanup. Like when we clean the center of the village here. Usually we try and do it the following day, if not 2 days after the storm.
Yep.
It just takes a little bit more time.
So I would make a motion to approve the $90,000 for the snow and ice.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 And this is actually the only item on your budget that you have approval of deficit spend, right?
Yeah, correct. That is correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
The only thing I have to do is if I think I'm starting to get close where I'm going to go over, I just need to inform you and then you need to be able to make a vote to allow me to overspend.
Yep. Okay. The second item, $424,5400 is street lighting. And this is just to kind of cover the cost of running the street lights. This doesn't replace them or any of that kind of stuff.
That's
right?
Correct. Electricity only.
Electricity only.
Electricity only.
Street lights. And we're, again, around $37,000 this year.
Roughly.
We have 39 and 19. We've kind of brought that down. We were doing 35 for a while. We went up to 40 and then kind of slowly brought it down to 37. We feel like that's pretty good, right?
Partly due to the solar has given us some credits back against
that.
So
great.
The last 2 years.
Oh, perfect. Okay.
Which solar?
One on River Road. What's that?
901 River Road, True Corp.
Lake Street.
Lake Street, that's right, it wasn't RE. So, find a, make a motion on this for 37?
I'll make a motion for $37,000.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So, test well monitoring would be the next, which is $439,5800. We've been since 2019 around $50,000, and...
In 2019, I think we actually had to drill another well, so it ended up costing more, but we did allocate money towards that during the year.
Yeah, I do, yeah, yep. So, for, do you know where, how we're at this year? I mean, we had signed a contract, right? And I think we're in pretty good shape at that number.
Yeah, I don't think we've spent more than $35,000, $38,000 maybe.
So far.
Roughly.
Yeah.
Does that sound right to you?
Correct.
Correct. I mean, excuse me, going with another company, another engineering company, they've been able to streamline some things.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's why we're getting a little bit better deal out of it now.
Who are you using now?
Yeah, we had a...
Oh, God.
Can't think of their name either.
I know it too, it's on the top.
No, no. Sorry, we're going through so many lately.
I know.
That's, the engineering firms are starting to kind of run together now. It was GZA, they left GZA and then went to, oh, God, why am I pulling a brain card?
Is it a B?
I can't remember off the top of my head.
Yes.
Basically, what does this cover?
So, basically what they do is we're required by DEP to monitor what we have, make it even shorter. We don't have a lined transfer, we don't have a lined dump. So, anything, as things start to deteriorate, goes into the ground and starts to migrate in different areas. And because of what they are, we have to monitor.
So, they've drilled wells kind of all around and then they test those wells to see if anything's seeping through. So, we've had to drill, right, another one a couple of years back.
Yeah.
Correct.
So...
It's for leachate.
Has there been any change in the plume?
Actually, the plume is pretty steady right now. I mean, it hasn't really gone out any further. Basically, you're looking at, if you're heading towards the northeast, it goes real close to Melnick's Farm and then kind of heads right out towards the river. And then fortunately, you know, I know a lot of people say, oh, my God, you know, the stuff's going in the river, but, you know, the dilution rate in there makes it non-existent.
Right.
Because of what it is. So, I mean, because obviously, otherwise, if there was a problem, DEP would be all over it.
Right.
Yeah.
You know...
Well, that's why you have the wells, so you can test.
See if they need to, they readdress it, yeah.
Correct.
So, make a motion to approve $50,000 for the test well monitoring?
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So, we're on town office building maintenance, this is $192,5400.
And you'll have a new one to replace the one that's in your current budget binders.
The one printed today, right?
Yeah, it's stapled to what we have.
Yeah, yeah, they should have stapled it right to the front and should have put a line through the other one.
Yep. So, the electricity is the same, the heating is up?
Yep, heating has gone up. We were able to cut back a little bit on the water.
The sewer is...
Sewer has definitely gone up. The last bill that we had was close to $6,000.
And I think that...
And it was because of that. I've already purchased a...
Separate?
A separate water meter.
Okay.
And Deerfield Academy is going to be installing it for us.
Oh, wonderful, very generous, thank you very much, DEA, to do that. So, that, we'll budget for that, but hopefully that'll come down during the year.
Right, yeah, because that's why I only went with $3,300, I mean, because otherwise I'd have to go like $65,000.
Right.
You know, just to cover it, so... And worst case is if something happens and it goes over, that's when I have to come back and say, hey, sorry, you know, things cost more than what we originally thought, so I need more money. Which fortunately I haven't had to yet, but it's going to be a day.
Our custodial services went up?
Custodial services, the costs are going up.
They are. I do at some point want to take a look at that contract and what we're getting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just think, I think it's time to just reevaluate how much we want cleaned and mm-hmm. how much more we want cleaned.
Mm-hmm.
And so, not this year, but this year we should look at that, and we may have to go out to bid next year on what we want to do again. I mean, we've done this company right. for a long time.
Right.
It does a great job. Right. I just think that it's time to change, not change vendors, but change what we want done. And that may cost more.
Mm-hmm.
But there's, you know, we just need to make sure things are looking good.
Yep. You know, the other thing is you may want to just keep in the back of your mind, you know, we talked about at one point in time, maybe possibly taking, in not this fiscal year, but mm-hmm. maybe for FY22, maybe doing our own.
I agree with
and,
that.
And if we do our own, now we can, the monies that are spent out that direction, because the library pays so much money, the senior center pays so much money. When they're at the senior center, they're only there one day a week.
And
they
food.
Show up and they serve food the next day. It's,
yes.
There's an issue.
There is.
Snow removal,
yeah.
As far as shoveling and salting and sanding and things like that. If we're out and about, trying to take care of the roads, I have to take care of the roads first
right.
and take care of thousands of people compared to.
Right.
But that's not right for the people, whether it be the library, whether it be the town hall, or whether it be the senior center.
No, I.
But I don't have enough people to be able to provide the service.
I felt like we've needed a town custodian slash handyman.
Right, exactly.
There's a lot of work.
Simple thing, because there's a lot of things that, I mean, because historically, I still come here and do stuff.
I know.
So.
And that's. We love you to do that, but
I'm expensive. I'm very,
very expensive.
Expensive you know?
Light bulb installer. So
yeah, exactly.
I'm not making fun of it. I just think, that we need to look at that and reevaluate how we do that.
Just Kevin Helsowski was doing that for a short time when he was with you, right?
That is correct. Yep. So you know, Chuck's been taking care of that. Plus, we got John Holhut. He comes over. But you know, a lot of the skill sets are. I can do almost anything. I can do plumbing, electrical, carpentry. Carpentry, I'm chainsaw perfect, but other than that, you know, I can pretty much do anything. Chuck is pretty much the same. John, he's young. He's only, 21, 22? So, you know, he's still got a ways to go, but he's very intelligent in what he's able to do at this point in time. Mm-hmm. As far as turning wrenches, working on equipment, things like that, hands down, no problem whatsoever, good common sense.
Yeah.
And just looks out for the best way of trying to do things. Comes to building stuff, electrical, plumbing.
Yeah,
he's still got to learn.
No,
and he's coming along, no doubt.
I'd like to get together and think about that.
Yeah. So it's just something just to, like I said, think about in the future.
The school needs the same thing, you know, the elementary school.
Miscellaneous repairs, I went up about 2,000.
Okay.
And that was just by...
could we combine departments?
Combining two accounts into one.
Okay. Oh, I see it down below.
Yep.
And then
everything
supplies,
else is...
Yep. Pretty straightforward. Everything else is.
Yep. And then we took the church building maintenance and went from 25 to 6.
Mm-hmm. And because we're not spending much for maintenance on that
no.
at the time, I mean,
right.
we're just kind
right.
of looking at it. We thought
nobody's
we'd be doing more.
Nobody's using the building,
right.
so it's pretty bare bones. So we felt, after looking at the last 2 years of expenses, that this was a more appropriate number to put in the budget.
For the year. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
That helps.
And then next one down from that is... $1,000 for the maintenance software program.
Mm-hmm.
That's
your new program?
We were able to get the asset management program that was funded through Maya Grant, which they took care of $9,000 of it. We spent $1,000 to go ahead and finish off the rest of the $10,000. The original plan, or the original unit cost of this before they were beat up, was almost $17,000. So between getting beat on pretty hard, they brought it down, and we just told them flat up, we can do 10 grand. That's all we can do.
Mm-hmm.
And then they kind of brought it down. And then we also got them to lower their yearly. So what this is there's going to be $1,000 to town office building. There's going to be $2,000 to wastewater treatment because all the assets of the sewer lines.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other one is going to be $2,000 for highway.
Okay.
So basically, $5,000 a year is my software cost to be able to run this program. The advantage of this program, which actually we're starting to meet, we're getting our training next week,
right?
On Tuesday and Wednesday.
I'm really excited for it.
I'm very excited for it. And right now, Chuck has got probably close to, I'm going to say probably at least 350, maybe 400 hours into this project already. by preloading all of this information, preloading all of our, doing overlays, talking with Esri, talking with the GIS people, talking with the pavement management, you know, the FERCOG. He's pulled them all in together and said, okay, you know, these are all the things that I need. So that way everything's already overlaid into the system ahead of time. We get the drop-down menus, which is huge.
Right.
You know, what he did was he went and asked, you know, he asked the questions, all the guys, you know, what do you think? This is what we came up with. These are the basics, and these are the tasks. Can you think of anything else?
Right.
And, you know, and of course, you know, there's always something we miss. So they came up with a couple, and we added those in there. So it just makes it very, very user-friendly.
So somebody calls and needs a tree done, you can...
Yeah, exactly. So what we'd like to eventually get to the point is going to be, it's not going to be like the 311 system where automatically it's generated.
Mm-hmm.
But we'd like to do it eventually, not right off the bat, because I want to make sure everything's up and running properly, is we'll go through the town website and have it emailed to us. But it's going to be requiring, you're going to have to give me your name, and you're going to have to give me your phone number, and you're going to have to give me an address, mm-hmm. or I'm not going to respond.
Right.
Because we need to, and the advantage of this is now we're going to be able to track who's calling.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if it's, obviously if there's a problem, we have to take care of it, but if there's a problem person, this is also going to address it too, because mm-hmm. now we have documentation. And fortunately with this is all cloud-based, so we don't have to worry about any servers or anything else mm-hmm. going down or going bad.
Right.
So this information that we're putting together is going to be forever.
That's awesome.
You know, right now, if I try and go ahead and try and find something that we've done in the past, I got to go look in one of the books
right.
and figure out and go by day by day by day and say, okay, well, right. what did we do?
Oh yeah, this
you
is
know, good. So this thank hands you. Down, this is money very well spent.
I was just going to say, I want you to know, I was at the FERCOG today, following up on our request for the culvert mm-hmm. evaluation. They are going to do it. Ryan was saying how wonderful Chuck was doing with the software, because he was loading the tree inventory.
Right.
He was
everything.
Loading
anything we can get our hands on.
We have 119 crossings that mm-hmm. have already been documented. So they already, he's putting them into the system.
Correct.
And so it's, and then Ryan is just going to load the information right on as he's doing it.
Great.
Instead of the information just sitting in a map on Pat's desk, this is already usable for
right.
for the
yeah,
highway
the
department. So I have to say, I'm really, really happy.
Yeah, I'm very excited about it. I mean, it's going to give us great tracking on what's going on. It's going to give us great tracking to find out if we're going to the same place continually, you know. I mean, obviously, if we're going there all the time, we know it, but this right here is going to give more of a tracking, you know. And this is going to break right down to street signs, stop signs, yield signs, everything. You
right.
name it. The only thing it's not going to do is pens and pencils. It'll do any of the light fixtures, plumbing in the building. If you want to do buildings, you want to do doors, you want to do locks, you name it, we can make it an asset.
Great.
And then you can track that from now until forever.
That's perfect.
So
it will do. One thing I wanted to talk about a bit was just, I know that we're doing the town advisory committee's doing a building,
mm-hmm.
building advisory committee is doing a study on this building especially, and then the others. But I wanted to think about, you know, I hope this study is, I think what I'm going to get out of this is what we need to do and when, or
mm-hmm.
is it worth doing, or that kind
correct.
Of thing, because I've been wanting to get this freshened up in here for a long time, and
mm-hmm.
I think of like, well, where do we put that amount of money to get this painted in here? I mean, there's a sense of appearance that needs to be a little bit more professional and
mm-hmm.
updated, and I'm hoping that report will tell us, you know, is it worth painting, or when do we paint, or
right.
when is that done in a schedule? Because, you know, we've all wanted to have kind of an asset management
yeah.
of when we can get that stuff done.
Sure.
We can budget for it, and it's just been a...
Well, I've already started on the paperwork for the sheriff's office to come down, and I'm trying to get them to do it this year.
That'd be great.
So, you know, basically all it's going to be is just going to be the cost of the paint.
Yep, that's fine.
So,
Kevin, that's wonderful.
We need it. We need it.
You know, and we've also reached out to them about trash pickup, too. Which my understanding is that they will do. They won't do the state anymore, but they will come down and help us out.
Great.
So, kind of nice.
Yeah, that'd be great to have that working relationship with them.
Sure. But does the outcome of this study being done on buildings get fed into this software program in terms of data input into that?
It will eventually, once it's complete, because presently, right now, the existing one that they're just finished off on was more of the questionnaire of what was going on. The second part of it, which is what we're trying to fund for this year, will actually be going through almost, for a poor choice of words, an engineering of all the buildings to look to see where we're at. Again, put together like a maintenance program, okay? You know, whether it be, you know, talking about the servicing of the HVACs or whatever it may be, you know. They say, okay, well, this unit right here, you know, it's got a life expectancy of 5 years. So once at 3 years, once you start putting some money away for it, because within the next 2 years, you're going to end up having to replace it. And that's the direction we're trying to go in, because right now for highway, I was requested a 5-year outlook for our capital improvement, and we put together a 23-year plan. It was very simple at that point, for the fact is our equipment is 20 to 25 years, our big trucks are 20 years, and our pickup trucks are about 10 years. So it was very easy to go ahead and put that together. It's a lot more difficult to go ahead and do that with a building itself. Mm-hmm. And that's hopefully what we're going to be getting out of this. And then we can go ahead and roll that right into the software program. And any of the maintenances that's going to be coming up, very similar to like arbitrarily, once a month you're going to come in, we're going to replace the filters to the air conditioning. Mm-hmm. And then while we're here, they're going to go through and they're going to hit all the fire extinguishers. They're going to make sure if they're looked, take them upside down, make sure nothing's crawled up inside the tube, then go ahead and write on the backside of the cart. So there's lots of things that are up and coming, but I think this is going to help us out dramatically.
Really looking forward to that a lot. So,
and not to get off subject, but what's the timetable for finishing that assessment of the building?
I want to say it's April. Okay. I'm almost positive it was April.
Maybe a report in May or June.
Yeah, we'll find out. I'm not positive, but I was hearing
sure,
April.
To be honest with you,
I'd have to ask that committee again. But you also have EMS maintenance building maintenance, and that was a new charge this year. But I assume that's funding out of our rent if we're going
to
be.
Well, that's kind of what I'm hoping. You know, I'd like to see the whatever we get for rents out of that building go to a. Enterprise, however you want to call it, enterprise fund.
We're setting
whatever.
That up. Yeah, we're setting that up.
You know, and have that very specific to that building.
It is.
You know, and not be tapped into for other things. So is what I'd really like to see.
So depending on the vehicle that you decide on, if you decide that it's going to be a stabilization fund, we can set aside a certain percentage into the stabilization fund, and then leave the rest in the general fund to cover this, plus the things that are in his highway budget that he does, like the lawn mowing and the snow removal and so on and so forth. Or if you decide that you're going to do a revolving fund for the maintenance of it, then you wouldn't need this $3,000 in this budget, because you would be paying for all the maintenance out of the revolving fund. So it depends on what vehicle you choose. For right now, I made an assumption based on the last conversation we had. You were thinking more of leaning towards a stabilization fund, so we put some in here just to cover, just in case.
Well, we were, but we hadn't had a chance to discuss it. I mean, it's one of those things that we need to put on the agenda fairly soon, so we can.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Casey's got it on her.
Good.
What we have to do is discuss the pros and cons,
right?
And figure out how we're going to track it, so that it's completely transparent.
Right. You were talking with Tom Scanlon, right? And we were talking to DOR about the best way to set that up.
Yes.
And we want
so we just
most flexible.
You have the two options. I think based on everything you've talked about, it seemed like the stabilization fund might have been a little better vehicle, but. Doing the revolving fund, then you wouldn't have anything going to the general fund. It would be all out of that fund,
right?
And that would be probably the most transparent, because everything would be in one spot. But totally up to you, and I know you've got some thinking to do about that.
Yeah,
but right now, we thought we'd have that in there, in case we need to.
Yeah, as long as the finance committee, everyone needs to know that
that's being paid for by
the. Scamps.
Well, the rents right now are actually going into general fund.
I know.
Which is basically where this money presently right now will be coming from.
And
so
we will
feasibly,
be transing.
Out of the $36,000 a year that you get,
right.
We're only looking for six.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Three.
Out of this budget. And then, of course, what he spends out of his highway budget, that'd be impossible to track. But, well, not impossible, but it'd be.
It'll be better once I get my software system put into place.
Take it right off.
So that's the kind of thing we're looking, yeah, and I assume there'll be another meeting to kind of decide that.
How are the expenses handled with the fire district?
What do you mean?
Pardon?
Well, you do the snow removal for the fire district.
Nope.
No?
Nope.
No.
Nope, we used to, not anymore.
Not anymore?
Nope, pretty much the state takes care of it, and the district went out and bought their own plow. So, yeah, so no, we don't touch it. We, all we touch is EMS. And to be honest with you, the past two storms, Dennis has been able to get over there quicker than we have.
Yeah.
So the fire department's been actually taking care of it for us. It's kind of a payback for all the years that we were helping them out.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Oh, that's really nice.
That's great.
Okay.
Really great. So, let's see, so I guess, take a motion to approve the budget?
$80,400?
Yes.
Okay, I make that motion.
I'll second it.
Any further discussion?
Yeah, I don't see the demolition of this building, but it's okay.
Nope, not yet. It's coming up. We gotta paint it first.
Oh, gotta paint it first.
Okay. Trevor, don't even joke. Oh, God.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, thank you. Let's see. So, general payroll looks like it's next. General highway payroll?
Yep.
Oh, right.
You know, fortunately for me, at this point, there's really nothing I can do about that. So what your numbers are what your numbers are.
Right.
With the, I was gonna say, the only thing that's in here this year that was not in here last year is the part-time clerical person that I think you had approved of earlier in the year.
Mm-hmm.
I'll let you guys talk about that.
So basically what I did was I put it in as a grade two, step three, which worked out to 1830 at 20 hours a week, which basically worked out to $18,080.
I think 19 hours a week.
19 hours a week.
So it was not a benefited position, yes.
And then the same one as last year's was 10,000 for the summer help for the two kids.
And
so those are the only two that you can really do anything to. The rest are cemented.
Yep. And the summer help worked out well?
Summer help worked out very well, I think. And what I'm really hoping is that this year, if I get this one, at least one of the same kids back, I can let him loose with somebody else. Mm-hmm. And I don't have to take one of our guys, because we still end up having to take one of our guys with them to get them going, make sure they understand, you know, especially, as stupid as it sounds, the weed whacking, especially when you get in the cemetery.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you got to be careful around the stones. It does not take much, especially the super old ones.
Yeah.
You start destroying the stones with the weed whacker. That's that's unacceptable.
Right.
So with all that being said, so there's a learning curve that goes along with it.
Sure. But he's had a year and maybe
he's had a year to with it, and then now that I've seen him, the one particular one I'm thinking about, I've seen him driving with a truck and a trailer behind it, which is something else that I was concerned about, to be honest with you.
Yep.
You know, I mean, you can go ahead and you can take somebody for a quick ride and something, and well, yeah, okay, but if you're able to watch them over a period of time, and then you can get a better handle on how they are. So I mean, I would feel comfortable with him. Go ahead and doing that. Yeah. So
okay,
and I believe, if you don't mind me interjecting, you're also taking on the maintenance, the lawn mowing, and the snow removal for the senior center.
For the senior center now, which we haven't done in the past.
Right, I appreciate
and
that.
And then obviously we took on the EMS, which we haven't done in the past, and because obviously it didn't exist. And now obviously we're taking over the next door at the church, which we've never done in the past.
Right.
So as far as that's concerned, I'm about strapped out.
Right.
We've got no extra time at this point.
One thing, just while I'm thinking of it, was looking at the handicap designation in front of the senior center, and you know, a lot of people pull in and park on that lawn, right?
Right.
So I'm wondering, does that want to be like TRG or something?
No, are you talking the very end right next to Sugarloaf? I mean, North Main Street?
Yeah, well, yeah, they'll pull in
on that far end. Oh, I'm sorry. No. Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
They'll pull in here, and
I
don't know what we want that. Do we want that still to be lawn, or do we want to make that a bit of a parking, or do we want to just define where the parking is out there and say, look, this is where you park? You know, I think they park there because it's easy to get to the ramp.
Right.
We want to make it easy, and we want to, you know, I'd like to have a designated handicap spot near that ramp.
Sure.
You know, we have it around the other side, but...
Correct.
So just look at that this year and kind of figure out what we want to do for parking.
All right. Well, you know, a lot of it's got to do with my opinion is a lot of it's got to do with what are we going to do with the building?
I know. And I don't want to do it.
And that's why, you know, I'm looking at, you know, paving, you know, do I want to pave? Do I want to go ahead? Because where we took out all the trees and we took out the fence, we opened that up over there. We can open that up for more parking too.
Right.
You know, which is okay when it's warm and dry. But, you know, wintertime, it gets icy whole nine yards.
Yeah, it's muddy.
And I'm having issues over there. So, but I'm not going to go ahead.
We'll have a bigger plan.
You know, Trevor, the only thing I know we should address it, but I kind of wanted to wait until we got further along with the building assessment. Because,
oh, yeah, I know.
Because that will direct us of what we're actually going to do.
Yep.
And then I want to make sure we have a coordinated landscaping plan for the whole general area here.
The main thing I really
which would include parking, obviously.
What brought to my mind was just even painting a handicap mm-hmm. spot near that
sure.
ramp.
Well, technically, there is a handicap spot right next to the ramp. Right
oh, there is. Okay.
Yeah, there's a sign there.
Well, oh, okay. So maybe we could do like we did out front kind of thing.
But there's not it's not designated in paint, which is right. no big deal. I can make
maybe
all that
when
happen.
When that happens in the spring or whatever.
Exactly. No, the other thought we had is at the very least, what we're going to do is we're going to put diagonal parking coming in, so that way when you come in off of North Main Street, you'll be able to, the church is on the right-hand side, you're going to have diagonal
nice.
Parking in there and diagonal parking on the left-hand side, and then we can add more, you'll actually get more spaces in that way. Obviously, wintertime, we don't want people parking over there because all the stuff is going to come off the roof.
Exactly.
So.
Yep. Okay. So I guess the big question is, this assistant and everybody on board with moving ahead with that? I mean, I think that was our idea, was to juggle kind of what gets done out of our office, move it a bit over there, so you had some help to do that. I know this is kind of, this was all got in motion before Casey was here. And
I'd
I don't
like
know
some
if you,
time to talk to Kevin about that.
Yeah,
because he and I have discussed it briefly.
Are we still putting it in the budget?
Well, we can always move it around.
Right.
And that's what we talked about earlier today. Mm-hmm. Because if we come up with a plan that meets everyone's needs, that may require some adjustment in his budget and our budget. So I'd like to have a little bit of leeway to talk to him about that.
You
don't publish your budget
tonight, or do you want to just wait?
What do you want, Kevin?
Whatever you'd like to do.
I mean, we can tell the finance committee that tomorrow.
Right.
That we've asked for a little time.
Why don't we leave it in? Because it's homeless otherwise, really. I mean, because you haven't really
decided.
Yeah,
you can leave it in.
Yeah, I would leave it in, and then we can decide how we're going to move it around or what's going to end up with it, because we still have another. I mean, we still have a couple weeks.
You still have at least
because this stuff is still fluid.
Weeks, yeah.
And I would say if you left it in, that might give you some leeway to make other changes down the road in fiscal 21 that you might want to make.
Right.
Yep.
If the clerical doesn't work out. Yeah,
right.
Just a thought.
Yep.
Right.
Okay. So I'd entertain a motion to approve the budget for $525,347, unless there's any other discussion.
I'll second it.
Is there any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
And yes, you guys work that out. Whatever you guys think is best is fine. So general highway expense. This is $422,5400. Let's see. We've got the $6,000 for rental equipment, which is the mini excavator that you've been wanting to purchase for $46,000, but got tabled a bit, and you want to rent, right? So that's kind of what you're hoping to use that money for.
Yeah.
You're only going to get about a month out of that.
Yeah, if that. Because actually, I'm still going to get kind of split up between that and like maybe a small little skid steer at the same time.
I was just going to say, what I wanted you to do, Kevin, is to make sure you rented both sizes that you had requested.
Yeah.
So that you could figure out what was the one that you feel was the most useful.
See, the only problem, and I'm not going to try and make this too long, and hopefully you can follow the bouncing ball, because it works in my head, and hopefully I can explain it properly.
Well, we can see it.
Is
yeah, there's not much up on top there hiding it.
So I was told, well, we want to rent for 2 years. Okay, so hear me out. Mm-hmm. So if we rent for 2 years, say $10,000 a year, that's $20,000.
You're halfway.
Okay, which is basically a third of the cost of the unit. Mm-hmm. So you're taking $20,000 and you're throwing it out the window if you decide in 2 years you don't want to do it. So let's go with the next thought of if we have a lease that's $14,000 a year, so it's $4,000 a year more, and then if year two or year three, year four, year five, you decide you want nothing to do with it, you walk away from it, doesn't cost you any extra money, there's no penalties for walking away. So let's just say arbitrarily in 2 years you say no, would you rather throw away $8,000 or would you rather throw away $20,000? Because the way I look at it, fiscally, it makes no sense to me whatsoever. But that's me because I have a vision of what the project, I see this equipment being able to do.
Well, I had that discussion. You know, my thought was, even just talking to you tonight about River Road and how we're going to address getting the pipe in that section that's sliding into the river, not down here, but further up, halfway up River Road. You know, last year we had, you know, emergency call and emergency work there because that thing was like shooting down right into the river.
And we lost about almost 7 feet
of the road.
Of the side of the road dropped.
And it dropped. And so it did that because a lot of the water is running off that western hill and coming down the road and saturating underneath the road, and that whole road is just slipping. So our thoughts are to dig along that side of the road and put in perforated pipe and drainage along there to get it down to either side has a
culvert
and a, you know, a way under and out to the river. But to do that with the equipment we have now, you've got to shut down the road because you're a backhoe, so you're going like this way with it, or you know, you don't have mini excavator, it's much smaller. And we were talking about culverts, and I talked to Chuck about this maybe 2 years ago, mm-hmm. when we started talking about that mini excavator. You don't need all the other apparatus with it. That right. thing can be there in one trailer or a truck,
yeah.
and it can turn and drop, turn and drop, and you can shut down one lane, not the whole road. So I just think, and with that and all the culvert replacement we have to do coming up, it makes sense to have a machinery that can do that, unless I'm extremely naive and we do have something there that can be used. I'm not a...
I mean, you know, you can do it with a backhoe.
Yeah.
For the simple fact is, obviously, the mini excavators didn't always exist.
Right.
But you look at productivity and you look at efficiencies.
Right.
And the way I look at it is if I can get something done twice as fast, that means I can get something else done in town, is what I try and do. I try and be proactive. I try and continually move forward to make sure that we're taking care of the things we need to take care of. You know, and if it takes me twice as long to do something, then it just takes me twice as long, and which means something gets dropped for a while.
Well,
so, I mean, kind of one of those is what it is.
Go ahead, Dave.
One of the things going through my head,
mm-hmm.
is the amount of time that the water district needs a mini excavator,
right,
or a backhoe or something, yeah. that maybe we can get into an agreement with the water district and lease together.
Possibility. Mm-hmm. I do know that
if that's feasible.
Shared services, maybe we get a grant.
And my general understanding as far as what the water department is, yeah. as far as their equipment is concerned, I think everything's kind of on a hold. Once Andrew left, everything got stopped. Because they were going to get a mini excavator, they were going to get a trailer, they were going to get a dump truck, they were going to do a bunch of things. And then all that got put on hold for right now until they...
I think they're close to getting another...
Until they can reconfigure what they're going to be doing down there.
The reason why I was concerned that the mini excavator might be too small for some of the things like along Bloody Brook, you know, that next size up that you were talking about,
right.
because of the reach.
Mm-hmm.
And I was worried about the reach and River Road as well, because some of the opportunity for culvert replacement and or putting in the prep,
there's
do
some stuff
reach.
That we're not going to be able to do it with that
right.
stuff. We're not even going to be able to do it with the backhoe. I got one on up lower road that I have to do this year, and I have to contract that out, or I have to go out and rent a full size excavator.
And that was why, you know, that's that other one, the one for $144,000,
yep.
that was the one that I was
the 308.
Yeah.
Because it's got a longer stick. You've got more ability. And realistically, you know, what I tried to explain to the capital at one point was, you know, I says, this could possibly, you know, eventually be replacing the backhoe, which inadvertently means that when it comes time to replace the backhoe, you don't have to. Yeah. And then everything kind of turned into a, and I said, you know what? Never mind. You know what? Stop. I'm taking it off the plate. Never mind. I said
know, Kevin,
anything. I'm not going any further with that. I'm not giving up the backhoe. so.
I know, but it seems like it's a, in my mind, it's a better purchase.
But you could, if you had a machine that was big enough, you wouldn't need the backhoe, right?
Yeah.
And so, in my mind, that was a better purchase.
Great.
And so, maybe if we work on this bundled notice of intent, so you have the actual work plan. I mean, we did get a quote of about $7,000 for Zach from Ty and Bond to put that, to do the plan with you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that would be an actual work plan. And you could then look at the work plan and say, that bigger piece of equipment is more applicable to what the bundled notice of intent. Mm-hmm. And so you can justify that this was not, in fact, a foolish investment.
Right.
This is the kind of investment. So
when I purchase stuff, I'm not looking for fluff. I'm looking for something we're going to
continue to be able
to make
things. No, but that was why I wanted us to rent the mini backhoe, the mini excavator, so that you could show that in actuality, most of the work we have is ultimately going to be that next size up with the longer reach. But, I mean, so I'm sorry it's going to be seemingly that you have, a denial from this Capital Improvement Committee. But I think the discussion really is this is a more practical equipment for you in the long run, and we can prove that when we do the bundled notice of intent.
Right. Well, I think one of the parts that they were concerned about, and I understand where they're coming from, is they're looking for the matrix of, well, how many hours are you going to be available, whole nine yards? Well, I really can't tell you that right off the top of my head, but what I have been doing since they've asked that is every time I had the opportunity, we would have used it, I've been writing it down. So I've been writing down, okay, you know what? I could have used it for 10 hours this week. I could have used it for 5 hours this week. I could have done this. I could have done that. With that being said, if I have it for the entire, if I lease it, then I can use it whenever I want. If I rent it, now I've got a small period of time that I have to do that. And again, one of the concerns that the Capitol had was how much am I going to be able to utilize it because of the amount of people that we have, and they made up really good points, summertime, because for the most part, we tell people, we tell our people for the highway, don't take vacation in the wintertime, which really isn't fair to people, but that's just nature of the beast. Mm-hmm. So now you've got people that have been here a long time. They've got a lot of time. Well, you know what? It's summertime, and then when summertime comes, that's when I'm trying to get the other projects done. So it's kind of a catch-22, So
just in terms of the vocabulary here, rent means short-term. Mm-hmm. Like rental, lease means a longer-term commitment.
Yes.
Lease to own it all.
Correct. Yes. Yep. Yes. Yep.
So basically, if we went with, and I'm just going to run the smaller one because those are the numbers that are stuck in my head. If we went with the smaller one, it would be a 5-year lease at $14,000 a year, and I want to say there was a buyout of like $6,000 and you own the machine. If you do a rental, you're going to pay anywhere between $4,000 and $5,000 a month, and that's all you've got it for is a month. So if you do the lease, 365, 24 hours a day, I can utilize it at any point in time. But when I'm constricted down to a rental.
So what I would ask is maybe on the vein of what you're writing down, could you list out for us the projects you would use it for,
mm-hmm.
and kind of the time frame you'd use it for, and then what the backhoe kind of the pluses or negatives of the backhoe,
right.
just to kind of figure out where we're at on that.
To move through the budget, I would think, I mean, we can talk about it with the finance committee, but I think if we do the bundled notice of intent. And we have, so that's mm-hmm. basically a work plan
right.
for 5 years. And then you give them some more information that you are collecting. I think we can go to a reserve transfer at something, further on
mm-hmm.
When we make a decision of of lease and size.
Right.
I mean, my thing is I just didn't want us to buy the wrong size.
Right.
And that was where I was coming from
mm-hmm.
on the Capitol, because I believe that we wanted to do the bigger one that
right.
you needed to rent eventually, because that's what the work plan is going to show.
Right.
But we haven't done it yet,
right.
so it's hard for me to argue with everybody else at the same
understand.
Time. So, but I think we can I think we can make our case, and I think the finance committee would rather have us make that decision later on. When we have solid information versus
information
let's just speculate and whatever.
So a reserve fund transfer request wouldn't work for something like that because we don't have a line item already set up? You would have to go to town meeting and do something out of free cash.
What if we put a line item in here for, don't you have?
It would have to be a specific appropriation. So like, for instance, Smith Volk, I know this is kind of off, but when we did the Smith Volk thing, when there were years that we didn't have a student at Smith Volk, we still had to allocate a dollar to that line item in order to do a reserve fund transfer request.
So this 6,000, so this 6,000.
If we rename that.
This is within his budget, so it's not a capital item, so it would be, you need to have a specific capital item, line item.
Not in his budget.
Or you.
Oh, no, not to buy it. I meant to decide whether we're going to lease.
Oh, I see.
So if we put, if, maybe we could put.
A lease would be a general expense item.
Yes.
So instead of funding, I mean, keep it funded right now at 6,000.
Got it, yes.
But knowing that it's underfunded for the lease, and then go back to the finance committee when we have solid information of which one to rent or lease.
And what projects
we're going to do.
Yes, sorry, I misunderstood you.
Oh, no, that's okay.
And just so you're aware, I did drop that in half today. That was 12,000 at 9 o'clock this morning.
Yeah,
right.
He changed it.
So I started looking at it, I started hearing what was going on with the different departments and where we're at with monies, whole nine yards.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, well, you know, I see where I can make some cuts. And hopefully I'm just not cutting too much, because if I cut too much, then I'm starting to cut services.
Mm-hmm. But Kevin, when we have something solid, when we actually have the bundled notice of intent, which will be the work plan,
right,
then that's a different story. Mm-hmm. And you can say how many, you can look at that and say how many hours is involved in this.
Yeah, right.
Right now, we don't have the hours.
So I'm just going to zip through this because we've got something in about 10 minutes.
Can I ask one question?
Oh, sure.
On the mini excavator, what's the size of the bucket and the depth that you're able to do?
I gave you numbers right now, I'd be lying to you. I can't tell you off the top of my head.
You know what, Kevin?
I want to say, what, you got them there in front of you? Because that's what I was just looking for, is I thought I still had all the lease information in front of me, but I don't. I purged my file before I came here.
Right here,
because you had the ability for a long stick.
It's a 24. It's a 24-inch bucket.
So that's about a 30.
Two foot.
We'll see.
12-inch and 48 tilted bucket.
I don't know, Kevin. This is the one you. It's right here. If you can tell me, I can't look. Decide what it really says.
That's the 305.
This is the one
okay,
that you.
So that's the 305. That's the shorter of the two, which should be.
See, I just thought it was too small.
Yeah, I can't tell you off of what I have here. I'm sorry.
All right.
If you're just doing a rental, you're restricted to what they have for rentals.
Mm-hmm.
If you do the lease, you can actually say, okay, well, you know what? If I want to go with the 305, the small unit, I want the long stick.
Mm-hmm.
So you can add basically.
You'd almost add like an extra nine feet
yeah.
to your reach.
This does say long stick.
Okay, it's an long stick.
Extendable boom.
Extendable boom.
Dipper.
Right.
Not boom.
So. In that particular one, it had a couple different. It had, I think, a 12-inch trenching in it. I think it had the 48-inch cleanup bucket within it. There was a bunch of different other attachments that went along with it.
Yeah, because I'm interpreting this as more of a need than a want.
Oh yeah. It's definitely. But again, it all depends on what you want to do. I mean, you know, if you don't have the appetite to do the projects, then that just means I've got more time to spend on something else.
Yeah, but that's
so
that's
I can
why
save money, but
I, but the,
stuff
I'm
isn't getting
at,
done.
You know, that's why I said the water district because you know there's excavating more than you are probably
right.
Because everything they do is subterranean.
Right.
And so if there's a way we can work something out with them, that make a lot of sense to me because, you know, let's face it, you know, even though we've got a boatload of districts in this town. We are one town.
Right.
And we should be working together with the groups.
There is some shared services grant money we could kind of try for.
I don't see why we couldn't, we approach it that way, but then also we can decide how much time we would actually use. This is why this is so important.
Well, let's work on that.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to leave the six in there now. We had $2,000 for software, which we understand what that's for. You had $6,000 in for culverts, which we put in last year as well, and that's to start working on doing some of the culvert work. You did go up on telephone, internet, pager.
Correct.
You were up at three a while back, and then we dropped it, and then we were 18 for a few years, but.
Right. Well, historically, let me give you a quick little background. Before everybody had a phone, once the cell phones became smartphones, the town had no appetite to spend the extra money for it. I have one employee that refuses to get a phone, and he still holds on to his town phone, the only one phone that the town is paying for. That has pretty much doubled in price because they eventually had to go to a smartphone.
Right.
So now it's $60 a month just for his phone. So like this phone right here that is on me 24/7, 365, I pay for it. This is my phone with no money from the town. And that goes for the other seven people, the other six people that work for me. They all have their own phones and there's zero support from the town for their phones. And I, for a poor choice of words, require them to make sure that that is on their hip during the wintertime.
Right.
Because I need them, you know, and even in the summertime, you know a storm's coming through, please make sure your phone is on. Please make sure you're close to it. You know, do I have trees down? Do I have this? Do I have flooding? You know, and it's the communication end of it, you know. Do you want to go back to a pager?
No.
You know, because originally that's what it was once upon a time. And then you can go to Nextels, and Nextels is flip phones.
In the private industry, typically they pay for, you know, a certain percentage.
Like a stipend. Well, that's what we do for the fire department.
Right.
For the two guys at the fire department, we give them $50 a month.
And this $3,000 covers what?
One phone, and then my internet and stuff over internet and phone at the highway garage.
So we're going to circle back to that.
Yeah, I think we have to do something.
Yeah, well, definitely, I'm not good with that. So
I'd give the employee a year to get rid of, either gets a phone or.
Or you deal with it from a personnel perspective, create a policy and get a stipend.
We're going to look at that.
Right.
We're going to look at that. So.
But I don't think you should take it out for now. It's something that would fall into actually putting a personnel manual together.
That's exactly right. Yeah, I just want to look at that. So and work on that a bit. So.
Next one down is a printer copier that was $500. That basically is a wash because it's coming out of
contracted
services.
Okay.
So that goes back to me. My building maintenance went up by $2,000. It's requirements of what I'm having to do.
Yeah.
It's
you
a
need
newer
to
building,
that building.
And I have to maintain it to a certain level.
Yep.
And I also have to maintain it to a legal level. Mm-hmm. You know.
Who does the custodial there? Does you? Okay.
You're looking at them.
Yep.
Me and the other guys.
Right.
So we don't have a service that comes, takes care of us. We take care of all our own stuff.
Mm. Thank you, Kevin.
You'll look at that too. But,
and then the rest of it, I believe, is
pretty much
as standard as it has been in the past.
Yeah. Right.
Which basically gives me an $8,300 difference from last year, which is a 3.39%, which the percentages are really kind of tough because, I mean, when you're looking at a percentage, it all depends on what the bottom line number is. You know, if you take the school went up 3.25, mm-hmm. but 3.25 on $9 million,
right.
You know, the dollar amount is a huge
right.
difference.
It
so
is.
A lot of times when people say, well, your percentage. Well, I take that percentage and I throw it out the window because it's all relative
right.
to what the number is. And you
it's
can't,
relative
what
you to need. Services, right?
What right.
For what you're services providing.
Are. Yep. What's the absolute increase?
I'm sorry?
What's the absolute dollar?
It's a 3.39 right now. Oh, the dollar is
$8,300.
$8,300.
$253.
Of what?
My present one right now.
So we can vote this tonight, and then I do want to, we could always come back and re-vote this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I do want to look at a couple of those things. Mm-hmm. So
I'll make
we'll
a motion
to
approve.
Let the finance committee know what they want to look at.
Yep.
Yeah.
I have
yep.
notes.
I can do that. Yep.
I make a motion to approve $253,350.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, well, so transfer station expense, the last one here. This is $433,5400. And we have payroll that obviously goes up. You're not adding any, are you adding any?
It's still four guys. Basically, the added hours works out to another $7,000. That's where I went from 47,000 to 54,000.
And that's some hours for a specific person?
Or that's for three of them.
For three of them?
For three of them, because what they're doing is they're expanding their hours out a little bit, because like on Mondays, Bud comes in on Mondays, he goes through, and he checks off everything, he goes, he makes all his phone calls, he calls in the dumpsters, right. He makes sure what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, Mike always comes in early, you know, because he's the Tuesday and Thursday guy.
Yeah.
He's there at 10 minutes of 7.
Yep.
Knowing full well that he doesn't get paid until after 8 o'clock.
Absolutely.
But he doesn't care.
Yep.
He comes in, he walks around, he picks up paper, he does whatever, makes sure everything's good and going.
Salt and sand.
You know, and then by realistically, we say the dump's open at 8:30, the gate's open at 8 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Because he's already gone through, he's made sure everything's all set, all the, you know, the bins have been opened up, and they're ready to go.
Okay.
So.
Yep.
Restroom, I think restroom is pretty much going to stay the same. I didn't see anything that were coming up that was going up on it. Trash compactor, we went down a little bit for the simple fact is we actually finally got the new compactor installed.
Yep.
So we're saving $300 a month mm-hmm. on that. And then my next one that is different from last year is my recycling. It went up $8,000, and I'm hoping that's going to be enough.
Yeah, I don't think that, is that enough?
Off the numbers of what they're showing me originally, yes.
Because they were thinking we were going to be about 28,000, right?
Right.
And that's where we're at.
Right.
Okay.
So that's kind of what I'm hoping is we're going to be okay with this.
Yeah.
And then the next one that drops down, which is different, is the $2,000 for the composting, for food composting.
Right. We added a bigger.
Because we had to bring a bigger one in. And to be honest with you, the past 3 months, our numbers have dropped dramatically.
How much
as far as people that are using it. Tomorrow I'm getting the full numbers from, because Jim, the Saturday guy.
Jim's amazing.
Man, he keeps track of everything. You know, there's 17
amazing.
Guys came over here, 14 people went over there, used this, 3 people use that. It's
he's very, very good.
Yeah, no, I agree. Awesome. So I'm going to get a better handle on that. And what I'm hoping is maybe people are kind of holding back a little bit because of the season.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know why you would
be doing something different. I was texting you pictures because it's overflowing.
Yeah, it was overflowing. And I went from a 2-yard to a 4-yard. I doubled it. And now I can probably go 3 weeks to a month between the dumping when
seasonal.
It was like every 10 days.
One of the things is it's the way it's set back. It's kind of very muddy.
It is ice, muddy there.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
I wonder
there's
if we could find a different
there
spot.
If you could get it closer to the blacktop in the winter.
I agree with
yeah.
that. I hate getting out
maybe
of there.
We can do that.
Afraid of falling or whatever.
That's a great point, Chris, because I feel every time I get out,
actually,
I'm like, my car is getting a mess because I'm always walking through the mud. It's just that water just comes down right there.
Right.
It's even icy.
Yeah, maybe on the other side of the steel dumpster or something.
Actually, that is
it.
A really good point.
Because the only thing that makes me nervous about, the reason why I'm staying on that is because the thing starts to leak.
Yeah.
If it leaks, I don't want it going all over the asphalt, which is going to go all the way across.
Yeah.
If it's going to leak, it's going to leak.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can do about it. And it's not like we're leaking out oil or hazardous material.
Right. It's just.
But I just soon not have a track all the way across and then go over, because the way that whole area is pitched, that will go right over to your paper and mm-hmm. container compactors, or paper compactor and your
yeah.
plastic tin.
So maybe if you could just
we'll tweak it over a little bit. And basically what we'll end up having to do is we'll put some cones up because it's, I mean, I can move at any time, but obviously if we start training Triple T, because that's who the people are coming in and doing it,
show
exactly what we want it, and then
yep.
we can go a little better with that.
That'd be great. That'd be
so,
really great.
Yep.
And then we'll just see, like in the summer, if it picks up again. If it doesn't, we'll just drop back to the 2.
Right,
I'll
go back to
hey,
the 2-yard.
Stuff
and I can full. Save a little bit of money.
Okay.
Dump bags, I end up having to go up because the price of bags have increased.
Okay.
The next one I went up is solid waste, which is basically the services that we get from the solid waste district. Historically, in the past, when we were getting revenues from the recycling, historically we were utilizing more than one of our quarterly payments by that, and we were kind of scolded by solid waste, saying you really shouldn't be using all that money towards that. And we're like, okay, so we only do one a year now out of the four?
Out of the four. Out of the revolving.
I'm missing that. I don't think I understand.
Okay, so because Franklin County Solid Waste District deals with everything for us.
Right.
They deal with the trucking, they deal with all of the contracts. They get a certain percentage of the
right.
tonnage.
Correct.
So historically in the past when we had the recycling and we got a little bit of money back, well, that money was going into a fund and we're utilizing that fund money to spend on Franklin County Solid Waste. Well, they said, well, you're spending too much money on us with that. We don't want you to do that anymore.
So they wanted to go into the general fund and mm-hmm. then come
yeah,
back
it's,
out.
It's a quarterly assessment.
Right.
And we've been applying at least two quarters
right.
of it to the revolving fund. And Janamine said, no, you really shouldn't do that. So, you know, maybe one.
What
so,
should we?
So we started applying right. three of the payments to the transfer station appropriation, but he never changed his budget. Mm. Until this year, because it went up so much.
Right.
Dramatically, like almost twice
well,
as much.
What you should do is probably change this then to, since you're going up anyway, is put the whole expense in there and then star it and say in the notes that you're getting back X number of dollars. And then
only until July 1st. After July 1st,
after
that's
July
all gone.
1st
no more.
Gone.
Yeah.
Thanks to the lawyers down at DEP and the
yeah.
MRF. They sold us down the river hard and long. They did it. They did us absolutely zero favors. So I'm extremely unimpressed with DEP right now.
Yeah,
they've got nowhere to sell it though.
There's a larger context. It's actually, and it's not even in the U.S. The context is way out in Southeast Asia. They don't have any place to offload it.
I talked to one of the guys. He touches. Forget 30 million homes a day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And he said, I have nowhere. You can recycle all you want. It's just
sitting
on the docks. There's
yeah.
no nobody will take it.
All right.
He said, I used to get all this money for it. Now it does. I can't even pay to get rid of it.
I wish you had been at his presentation
he
at
was
the
amazing.
MMA conference.
Amazing.
You know, and it's and forward. This really super sad part is it's almost getting to the point where it's going to be cheaper to throw it away than it is to recycle it.
Yeah,
yeah.
Luckily
but,
still not.
Mass general law, the statute does not allow you to do that.
Yeah.
So
exactly.
I'm not
plus
saying.
It's still, and he was saying it's still a whole lot more money to throw it away than to recycle. So please
right.
still
yeah,
recycle.
That was his.
That
okay.
was his main goal. But yeah, it's tough. But it'll work itself out. It's just going to
there'll
take
be
a
market
bit of
for it, but the facilities
right.
have to
and
be
have
built.
At some point.
I think they have 13 plants that are coming online.
In a 18 to 24 month period.
Yeah,
right.
So it's
going to be a little while. And the reason why I kept it down to where it was, I didn't go, oh, you mean higher, is because I know we've got some money that'll get us through this year.
Okay.
Great.
So I figure if we can get through this year, the next year when we don't have the money, then that's when I'll ask for it. Because again, I mean, I looked at this and again, I'm looking at percentages.
Right.
12, almost 12.5%. You're talking almost $23,000. I went
we
up.
Knew that was coming.
I mean, you know, it's. I had to find a cut someplace.
So where do you see the cost of an annual transfer station sticker and the cost of bags going?
So.
All depends on what the appetite of the town is at this point in time, because basically you've gone up about $24,000.
Yes, 23.
Roughly.
What we used to deficit spend this account in the it was 150 plus thousand. Over the years we've worked it down to it's almost break even.
It's supposed
so
to be at a break even.
And it's paid.
Well, it's 23,000 up right now.
So it's paid for itself the last few years.
Right.
In 2019. We took in less money on stickers. I have to wonder if there's some manipulating people are doing. But we took in less money on stickers in 2019. So we actually...
By almost $10,000.
Yeah, barely covered the budget in 2019. In 2020, we might be about 20,000 short.
Do we know?
And I'm figuring for 2021, we're going to be at least 32,000 short.
Can I ask a question
okay.
though on that?
Mm-hmm.
Did we sell the same number of stickers?
Well, I don't know.
They couldn't have, because otherwise, because the sticker, because we the sticker cost has been the same the past 3 years in a row.
We haven't changed the stickers.
No, I know, but if we're taking in $10,000 less in stickers, then we've sold the same amount of stickers.
But that's what we're getting at. We didn't sell the same amount of stickers, because if we sold the same amount of stickers, the number would be there.
But that's like 100, that's more than 100 stickers.
I know, isn't that odd? But when I looked at this figure between 4 and 5 o'clock tonight.
How can we have like 100 different?
Where is that $10,000?
Yeah, 100 people did not just drop off.
But as an average over the last 10 years, straight average, we've taken in $176,000 a year. So you can see where that's.
Yeah.
But I think actually, you look at a trend is when you're turning over residences and new people coming in, these other services that pick up. I mean, I'm just, I don't have the data, I don't have statistics,
picking up,
but I'm watching and they're contracting with Amherst Trucking.
Correct, yeah.
Oh, maybe that's true.
Because they're, you know, culturally they're not used to going to a transfer station if they come in.
Yeah,
so
maybe that's why.
100 people dropping off, it seems like a lot, but.
Maybe.
10, 20, 30, 40 a year, I could see it happening based on the transitions going on.
I think a few years ago when you started requiring proof of residency for the stickers also, that created a decline.
Right. Yeah, for a simple fact, I mean, you got one town that's real close to us that they have no, you are required to have a pickup service because they don't have a transfer station, they don't have a dump. Mm-hmm. So,
but I bet if you did that, if anybody done the financial analysis with these other services, it may come close to if you did the transfer and all the bags and did everything like that. But frankly, I like seeing Mike and Bud and chatting with them, et cetera. So there's a social aspect to it. But I bet financially, if I actually cross my T's and dotted my I's, it's probably break even.
Yeah, pretty close probably.
But I know there's people like myself that I actually got a dumpster because I was traveling a lot.
Yeah.
And my wife is not going to go to the dump.
Right. Well.
So it was, so I got a dumpster so she could just walk out and throw it in the dumpster when I wasn't around.
I know, that's pretty nice.
One of the things I was concerned about when I was looking
at this. One of the advantages of marrying a redhead.
Is the cost, how much the costs have gone up in good faith. I can't ask for any more money for stickers, and I certainly can't ask for any more money for bags. Another 50 cent a bag, if you're in Montague, they come in and pick it up for you.
Right.
We are the most expensive sticker around.
That sticker bag combination, we're the most expensive town.
But we're breaking even. Are those other towns breaking even?
Balance that against the alternatives and make sure it's market based.
Exactly.
Price.
Well,
otherwise.
We're running a break-even operation.
Exactly,
versus,
and that is the difference between the two.
Versus being subsidized by the general fund. Because some, like you say, it's a choice. Do you go to the dump or do you have pickup service? And you can't, the people that are paying for the pickup service shouldn't be subsidizing the transfer station.
Right.
I mean, at least in my mind.
We try to keep it off.
And that's why we work so hard over really like a 10-year or 14-year period
to keep it, to bring it back to pay as you throw, which is
remember
the whole
when HAP,
it's called
HAP
a pay as you throw program.
Was
correct.
Running like 150,000,
yes,
160, 70,000.
Only 60% was covered at the time that
I know
the
it was
Marshall
a huge
shepherded that along.
Yeah, it was a huge deficit, and so we've been chipping away to make it a break
with
even.
With the abolishment of the EPA, we might as well just big hole and start burning it again.
Okay.
Nobody's got to come for you.
Hey, you know the other way? Okay. I can see where you can save $207,000.
I will make a motion. I think this is a worthwhile follow-up at some point, but
yes.
I make a motion for the current budget of $207,100.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Kevin, thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll do another night on that.
Kevin, I have been out straight, but I'm going to work on this. I'm going to work on the bundled notice of intent some more and talk with Zach, and then I'll have him get with you.
Oh, yeah, definitely, because I've already got a basic format already played out. All I need is I just need an engineer to finish the stamp with the PE that will keep both DEP and the CONCOM happy.
Right.
able to do that is going to make a big difference.
Right. So I'll work with Zach on that, and we already sort of got a quote, and we'll make sure that that goes forward. Mm-hmm. And then I feel like we could go to the Finance Committee and have a better discussion. Yep. Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. So the Finance Committee will take this up tomorrow night with recommendations.
All right.
Cool.
Excellent. Before you leave, one last question for you, not to do with budget. Yeah. Survey results. So Oxford and Leary. Anything yet?
The only thing that that has been produced so far is strictly the south end, which is the extension of Merrigan Way, which extended it 225 feet only, no cul-de-sac, no going out to the following around over by the access to South Main Street over by your house. Yep. We did not go that far. We only went through far enough to make sure that Pilot had a legal lot.
Yeah.
For poor choice of saying it.
We want to put the RFP out for that.
Correct. The other information for the north end of it, we thought all of that was supposed to be coming through, and then as soon as we went ahead and we saw the information that came through from the engineer, or not the engineer, but the surveyor, it did not include that. So I'm like, where's this? And they were like, oh, well, that wasn't part of it. And I'm like, well, it needs to be.
Right.
Like, now.
Right.
So.
And your easement.
Right.
Sewer.
Right. Yeah. And my easement for my sewer. So.
Okay. Well,
we can
light a fire under them and get this done. Because
right. No, I agree. Yeah. Yep. So that way.
But
you know, I think Casey knows where.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. And she's on him. I'm on him. So we're getting through. We'll make it.
Thank you
for coming in tonight.
Nope, no problem.
Thank you, Kevin. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for all you do and all your team does for us.
Thank you. Let them know.
Please do.
Yep. It looks like another mild week at least.
Hope so.
Thank you.
I'm okay with that.
Snow and ice the next couple days. That's all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No problem.
Kimberly, thank you for waiting. Thank you for coming tonight.
Let's see. I'll just.
Do you want a chair, Kimberly?
Well, I can use one here, Casey. Thank you. Let's see.
Kimberly, you're going to be really, really mad at me.
Why?
What?
Nothing.
Oh.
Just don't get people mad at you.
Honest. Well.
All right, so.
We'll start, and then you can be mad at me.
I'm going to go kill the lights.
Because
don't want to be able to see. Do you want to start?
That sounds.
No. I have so much going on. I can't find something that I was working on. So.
Oh, okay.
I'll tell you about it at the end. It's just something I think we could do. So, anyway, thank you. We're going to have the hazardous mitigation plan public hearing, and Kimberly from the FERCOG is here. She is working with us as a town. We have a committee that has been meeting off and on. Our plan expired in July, and we're trying to get it renewed. The only good thing is, since we, you know, passed the calendar date of two, you know, now we got another year added on to our plan, because now it's 2025, it will be hopefully renewed, too.
All right. So, let's see.
What can I do to help? Anything?
Well, I was... And do I have to use the microphone?
No,
it's right there.
One
yep.
Right here. Oh, great. Okay. Thank you, everybody. I'm here tonight to talk about the Hazard Mitigation Plan Update Project. This is a project that dovetails nicely with the work the town did a couple of years ago at the MVP workshop, and also all the follow-up work that the town has been doing with their MVP action grants. The multi-hazard mitigation plan is required by FEMA. An approved plan must be in place in order for the town to be eligible for pre- and post-disaster mitigation funding. And the purpose of the plan is to help the town reduce potential losses from future disasters. So in 2014, we completed the hazard mitigation plan, and it looked at historic hazard events, vulnerability assessment, looked at past events, and all of the hazards were prioritized and included in action items for each hazard. And the reason why I'm emphasizing past, how the old plan looked at the past to inform the future, is that this current plan is a new approach. So we're incorporating climate change and thinking forward when we're thinking about how these natural hazards impact the town. So in 2014, this is the list of hazards that we looked at. These were the ones required by FEMA. In 2020, we've added drought, invasive species, and temperature extremes, which are extreme cold temperatures and extreme hot temperatures. So the thing to realize, and I'm sure you've all, you're probably well acquainted with this because of all the work you're already doing as a town, but the changing climate is really exposing us to greater risk. So all of these hazard events that we're used to experiencing, like snowstorms or rain events, they're happening either with more frequency and or more intensity. The higher temperatures are, you know, resulting in shorter winters. We've got droughts on the one, we'll have a drought in the same year as we have really intense rain events. So climate change, like I said, is amplifying these risks. As part of the hazard mitigation plan, we looked at the infrastructure, the public health, how things are impacting the residents of the town, also how the hazards are impacting natural resources, and to, you know, a very minor degree, kind of like the economic impacts when you think about things such as farming, for example. Also just the infrastructure impacts are like we were just talking about, you know, can be very costly. So the goal for all of this work is to protect the life, the property, the natural resources, and the local economy. So higher temperatures are one thing that we addressed, and so these projections are taken from the state's new Resilient MA website, which includes a lot of climate change data, and they've what they call downscaled it to the county level and also to the large basin level, so like the Deerfield River watershed, for example. And the two different colors are just the projections under different emissions scenarios, but the takeaway really is that the average annual temperature is projected to increase about 5 degrees by mid-century, and up to, in the worst case scenario, about 7.5 degrees.
Which is completely unsustainable.
So the extreme temperatures, extreme hot days or heat waves are three successive days of temperature in excess of 90 degrees. So under the lower emissions scenario, by 2050, they project that we'll have 18 more days of these very hot temperatures. And by the end of the century, over 36 days. And just by comparison, between 1971 and the year 2000, we had an average of 4 of these extreme temperature days. So if you want to be really depressed, you can go on to this Resilient MA website.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking.
Yeah. And it's actually a really great tool. There are a lot of interactive maps and charts and everything. Changes in precipitation. Again, I'm not telling you anything that you aren't always familiar with. We're seeing less snow and more rain in the winter and heavier precipitation events overall. And it's not just limited, you know, to like the what I was just describing, but you have these bigger storms, tropical storms, thunderstorm cells, snowstorms, drought, and you know the frequency that these events are going to be happening is increasing, the intensity of the events and the duration. I mean, they basically just come and sit over an area. So in 2020, these are the hazard ID and risk analysis work that we did. And we determined the top priority hazards. We also looked back at the MVP workshop results. And this is what the completed hazard identification and risk analysis looks like. The highlighted hazards are the high priority hazards that were identified in the 2018 workshop. And you'll see that, you know, for the most part, the overall hazard vulnerability rating for those highlighted hazards is similar in the hazard mitigation plan. So one is a high vulnerability rating, two is medium, and three is low. This is one of the things that when you look at the plan, because the comment period is opening tonight and the public and interested parties can take a look at the plan and comment. So this is one thing that people might be interested in looking at. The vulnerability assessment, again, we looked at how climate change is impacting these natural hazards. And so the plan includes a description of the hazard that's quite, robust. And then the vulnerability discussion looks at vulnerable populations in the town, the health impacts of some of these hazards, and like I said, economic, infrastructure, and environmental impacts. And so if that list sounds familiar, it is, because it kind of mirrors what the MVP program is looking at, as well as what the state hazard mitigation plan is looking at. So mitigation strategies were developed for most of the hazards, but in particular the high priority hazards that were identified. For each hazard, we have hazard problem statements that were developed as part of the conversations that the committee had. We also brought forward any action items from 2014 that were still relevant, and we provided a status update. There were some things that the town had made some progress on, but there was still work to be done, so those things are included in this plan. And then there are some new action items as well. So the next steps are the public comment period is open for 2 weeks, and people are encouraged to take a look at the plan. If they have any questions or comments, they can contact me. The plan is going to be posted on the town website, and I gave Casey 3 hard copies of the plan for people that like to
read
with paper.
Read
a hard copy. And if we maybe have 5 minutes or so, please. I'd like to just go through. Casey, did you pass out? No, my stack's pretty big. So this.
No, I did not. But I can't.
This is the action.
I'm going to go turn the lights up a little bit.
Thank
Are
you.
We done on here?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, and it's important. Did the board? Everyone sign in from the board? Because maybe we can circulate it.
Okay. Does anybody want anything in the audience? There's one. You can say no to paper. It's okay.
So, I wanted to just make sure, and I'll leave these extra copies of the action with you, Casey, because it might be that some people just want to look at
pick them up
this.
And look at them. Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
So, because flooding was one of the bigger or one of the high priority hazards, quite a few of the action items are related to flooding. And you'll see in the status column, which is the far right, we indicated if an action item was new or if it was updated and carried forward from the 2014 plan. So there are quite a few new action items that I just wanted to go over quickly and see if there was any...
I think the only one that we're really missing maybe on the first group is I think we really want to say, we want to put that River Road in there too.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
River Road?
Yeah.
Great. So we'll add River Road.
Yeah, and the reason why, and we just add River Road in its entirety because
there's a couple sections that are...
There are at least three sections, right, Kevin? Do you want to add Lower Road? We did not add Lower Road because you were going to work on that anyway. Okay.
But River Road there.
But River Road, we have at least three different spots that...
Yeah, I know.
Sections that...
Yeah, so we had...
Well, Kimberly could clarify that with Kevin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Details on River Road.
It's both ends and in the middle, so...
And I just put River Road in its entirety.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Stillwater Road, Depot Road, Graves Street, and Mountain Road. I mean, we have quite a long list here.
Mm-hmm.
But then Lower Road, you said no, Kevin?
Lower Road, we should have done right now.
Okay.
No, but
we have 2 weeks.
You have 2 weeks to add it.
Well, the frequency of the storms, we should know in a no time.
It floods on what?
McClellan Farm.
Oh, yep.
At the upper end, right? Okay.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So we'll add that. Thank you.
Yeah.
That's true. McClellan Road.
Thank you, Lynn. I had forgotten about that one too.
And then the next. So any other areas related to road flooding, undersized culverts? I mean, we do have some mapping for that, and I know that the COG is going to be working with the town.
Exactly, identifying all that.
Yeah, Ryan confirmed that today, that he was doing that, so we're thrilled.
And we have the culvert on Hillside Road that floods.
Hillside Road, I don't think I have that one.
No.
So we'll add Hillside Road.
You mean the one closest to Main Street here?
Yeah. No, the second one up.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I know. Right.
Where my brother it's actually Bloody Brook area. Yeah. Because the whole basin comes down into that.
Into that one.
Into that one.
Isn't that was one of the ones that we were targeting to clean
that's
out.
Right by my brothers.
Okay. So let's
Kimberly's taking notes.
Yeah,
I'm writing down. I got Hillside Road.
Good.
Yeah, I think.
And then
that's a good one to write.
So the another new action item was to identify floodproofing options and bank stabilization measures for the Stillwater Road public water supply, and I realize that's the water district and it's separate from the town, but I think it's important
to recognize that and help them identify.
They would not have their own hazardous mitigation plan, so
right. I am in. Yeah.
Yeah. The idea was to include them.
Of course. Yeah. I'm not sure they appreciate help.
And then on the next page, this is something that was identified in the 2018 MVP plan, and we're listing it as a new action item in the hazard mitigation plan. Is this idea of looking at land, particularly farmland, in the 100-year floodplain or other areas that are flood-prone to think about conserving these areas or protecting them so they can serve as kind of release valves during a flood event. So the locations that were identified in the 2018 MVP plan were the north and south meadows of Old Deerfield, along the Deerfield River and West Deerfield, and Bloody Brook watershed. So are there any other areas that people are concerned about?
Well, where in Bloody Brook are you ever gonna let loose?
Do what?
you know, let a valve off and flood, other than the houses that are along flooding.
Oh, no. We were talking about the farmland.
Along that area, yeah. Like up Carish, kind of that way?
The Yazwinski Farm, some of that is under APR already.
Oh, the, on North Main here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty much where the only spot.
Yeah, everything else is developed.
Yep.
Okay.
But this is the same as South, you know, South Meadows is pretty much preserved. North Meadows right. is not, but, you know, so the
Kevin,
idea
is the culvert on Thayer Street for, I don't know what brook that is.
Black Brook or something?
No,
Blacksmith's Brook?
Blacksmith's Brook.
Is that, well, I know there's work that has to be done there, but is that's probably a concern too, right? Because that's a smaller culvert.
That's a smaller culvert, but for the most part, we don't.
You don't get a lot of flow there?
Yeah, we don't get a lot of flow from there. 20 some odd years I've been here in town, I've never seen that more than half full, and that was during a super extreme event, like one that I've never seen before. So that historically, that.
I've seen it at road level before.
I'm sorry?
I've seen it at road level.
Wow.
Really?
Well,
it doesn't hurt to add it.
Yeah, why don't we add it?
It's evaluated.
Yeah, what was the road?
Thayer Street.
Thayer Street. Okay.
But I'm old, so.
Yeah, but the whole purpose of this is there. You have to put into context that moving forward, you can't look back at the historic events.
No, because when you talk about the 100-year flood, there's pictures of rowboats going down North Main Street here in South Deerfield.
Wow.
So.
But when was that? Was that in 38?
Yeah.
Okay.
36, actually.
Or 36?
Yeah.
When? What was the difference? Was the 38 storm worse than the 36 storm?
For coastal.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So 38 was coastal?
Well, it was more devastating for the coast.
Right.
It was
we still
ice,
had an
it
impact.
It was an ice dam and the bridge that kind of backed up everything, right? That
well,
36?
Well, sorry, Phoebe, but the reason the bridges went out was because there was one bridge in Vermont that went out. Then as it came down the river,
took
everything out of it as it came down through.
Okay. Well, that makes sense.
And that was the 38, I think.
Oh, okay. But, all right, so.
But it's like Irene, you know, it was because Harriman let loose a lot of water, and that was what contributed to a lot of damage here in Deerfield.
I know.
But that's a different state.
So the next new one that was developed was related to a drinking water assessment in order to determine what percentage of the town's population is served by the existing water districts and which ones are not, identify the underserved areas, potential sources of drinking water that may need to be identified and protected. In particular, River Road, wells on River Road were called out because of they're not potable due to hardness and natural sources of arsenic. So, again, this would be something that the South Deerfield Water District and the Deerfield Water District might, in conjunction with the town, consider doing. And so when you're thinking into the future and with potential drought on the horizon and extreme temperatures, this is kind of the thinking behind this action item.
Mm-hmm.
Just
a lot of our water actually comes out of Waverly,
mm-hmm.
South Deerfield.
Well, didn't Old Deerfield and South, oh, that was just mainly for firefighting, right?
Yeah. But the
they hook together.
We also have a well field on the end of Sugarloaf Street
mm-hmm.
that could supply the town. And that's recently been cleared from Timmick, so, and that's why.
Oh, it has, because I.
Yeah, we weren't sure about that.
Yeah.
I talked to one of the commissioners. He said they got it's been clear for a couple of years now. But this. Because it hasn't been used, the water flow is very diminished now
okay.
on the well points.
Okay. Huh. Hmm. Well, that's good news.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that was capable of supplying South Deerfield at one time.
Mm-hmm.
not for fire protection, but for drinking water.
Right. Let's see, I was just going to see if there were any others that I wanted to point out. Oh, well, so to that point, so on page 235, there is the first action. Oh, is it?
Ooh. Kevin, thank you.
I was ringing for like minutes in there.
So at the top of
you could fix that.
Yeah, I would have cut it pretty quick.
Thank you. Well, at the top of page 235, it sounds like maybe we should update this one. It says hire a consultant to conduct a groundwater testing and a feasibility study of pumping existing wells in South Deerfield to lower the groundwater level to help alleviate localized urban flooding and provide backup municipal drinking water supply. And I mean, the committee downgraded the status to low for this. In 2014 it was high, but then it went to low because it just sounded like it would probably be a very expensive project to do, but it sounds like maybe we should update this status if you think it's appropriate to say that the EDB is no longer a problem.
I don't know, Dave, what do you think? Do you think we should put moderate at least?
This is a problem that's going to be getting worse in town. Because the DEP prohibited the sump pumps from dumping into our sewer system.
Mm-hmm.
Since that's happened, the groundwater has been rising in town. And it's just will be causing more and more problems. The aquifer that is tapped for the well fields is actually comes through a different aquifer flow.
Okay.
Then what's flooding the Bloody Brook Basin.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little different.
Do you feel that the way this is written is correct?
Should we move it up to lower the level?
I would put it up to at least moderate priority.
Yeah, because
I mean, it's not our decision, but we could talk to the water district.
Well, it's
going
to be affecting the economics, because, you know, Kevin probably can attest, because he's in a lot more homes around here than I am, but the almost every home in North King Street, Sugar Street, has some type of water issue,
mm-hmm.
and it's just getting worse.
I have 3 sump pumps in my house.
Huh?
I have 3 sump pumps in my house.
Yeah.
So we'll bump that up.
So that's the economics of the Deerfield.
So the theory is we get the wellheads working again, we're drawing that water, and it's starting to lower the level, water level in town.
Well, I know it's anecdotal, but you're bringing all that water in,
mm-hmm.
you're watering everything, some of it evaporates, but the majority of the water you're bringing in, and then you're watering everything, and you're not drawing anything up. We're at the bottom of the bowl. It makes total sense that we should be drawing down. So, I mean, I would at least put it up to moderate then, Kimberly.
Okay.
I would alter that.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
And maybe we can have some discussions with the water district.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, as long as they can pump it and put it somewhere that's not going into the sewer system.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
And then the other one I wanted to call your attention to is on the next page on 236, and it's about the 2 wastewater treatment plants. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to make sure that that I had the status correct.
Okay.
And
this is one we didn't have. This is on Little Meadow Road, Kevin. That we got the nearly $800,000 grant that we had to give back because our hazard mitigation plan was not approved in 2014. It got stuck down at DC for how many months? I don't know. 2 years? Anyway, so the problem never went away, so I wanted Kimberly to put it in. It's just that we haven't had any events to make it worse.
I agree hard. I mean, we get another Irene that comes through. Mm-hmm. Your sewer pipe from coming down there is going to be exposed.
Yeah.
You're less than 15 feet away from the way it stands right now.
Wow.
So, and then once it becomes exposed.
Right. Oh, it could be a disaster.
You know, the only other way would reroute the sewer through.
And that was almost a $1 million project back in 2013-14.
Yeah.
So that will be hugely expensive.
And
so
the water infrastructure going out for the plant also is right next to it.
Right.
Well, okay. This is definitely a new.
Yeah, it's still high. Okay. And let's see. I think those were the ones that I just wanted to call out specifically, but please, once you do take a look through this, if you have any comments, please let me know.
Are you ready to be
posted on the website?
Yes.
So people can view it?
Yep, so actually that's a good suggestion. I can send Casey just this document.
That would be perfect. And then you can get up there and people can kind of understand what
we're
working
on, through your,
what we're assessing.
This breakdown.
Yeah, right. This would be really great.
Are you ready to be mad at me?
Not, so everyone's, let me just say, so everyone signed in?
Yeah, oh, well, Chris hasn't yet.
Yeah.
So we'll have another person.
It's all over there.
I have not signed.
You signed.
Because I have a special sign-in sheet.
Oh, you did.
For
okay, good. We're here.
Okay. Casey's on it.
I'm on
okay,
it.
Good. We are here.
Chris, you need to sign in. So this is what happened. I was at a Homeland Security meeting, and I found out that Berkshire County is adding a vector-borne disease section to their hazardous mitigation plan.
Oh.
So I got a copy of it.
Okay.
And rather than freak you out that it was going to be one more addition, I started rewriting it.
Okay.
But fortunately, I had photocopied a couple different copies of it before I started rewriting it.
Mm-hmm.
I can't find my notes on the rewritten one. I know it's somewhere.
Okay.
But so I was wondering if we could add this. It needs, there's no of our own statistics from our tick tests and stuff, mm-hmm. but it is to add, you know, the ticks and mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I want to do that is because this past year was such a bad triple E year.
Right.
We want to be able to apply for money if there is a bad year.
Okay.
And not have to financially take it. Because I think that there would be money available, and mm-hmm. if we add it to our hazardous mitigation plan, then you know, that will cover us.
All right, that sounds good. So do you have this electronically?
I do.
Okay.
Because Allison had, from Berkshire,
had
forwarded it to me. So forward it to you.
Yeah, so send
But I'm sorry, I have, what it was the statistics for our tick, from our tick tests,
mm-hmm.
and our statistics for, I mean, we've had West Nile disease for 7 years here. So
right.
I was putting in the data of, you know, graphing the data that we had for the mosquitoes. So,
okay. Well, if you find that in the next 2 weeks, just
oh,
let me
yeah,
know.
Oh, yeah, I'll find it.
Yeah.
I know. It's. I thought I actually had it in my bag, but I didn't. So
and,
I apologize.
Oh, yeah, so this is not a problem to add, and we'll put it in the other, what's the other hazards section, which includes man-made hazards, you know, the discussion
okay.
of the Deerfield rail yard, transportation and fixed facility hazards. We talked a little bit about vector-borne diseases or the impacts on public health when we were talking about extreme temperatures and like rain events, but this is nice.
Well, this what this does is add this as a separate exposure.
Yep. This is great. And so
Yeah, so this is great, and we can give credit to BRPC for their good work, and thank them for this. So that's not a problem.
Thank you. I really have been working on it. It was one of my to-do list things, and I can only find the
Don't worry about
edited
it.
Edited ones.
And also, if you have any other things, Kevin, let me know. That would be great. All right.
Thank you so much.
You're
for
welcome.
All you've done for us in getting this.
Kimberly, thank you very much. So, what's do we have to actually formally vote it in at the end of 2 weeks?
Not yet. No. So what happens next is at the end of the 2 week period, I send the plan to MEMA along with they call it the plan review tool. The MEMA staff look at it. If they have any corrections, we respond to that. And then once it's ready to go, they send it to FEMA. And actually, FEMA staff have been turning these around very quickly, which
no
is
kidding.
Amazing.
Well, they fired that woman, that's why. So, okay.
So, and then what happens is FEMA issues an approval pending adoption, and that's when the board
votes.
Formally adopts the plan.
Okay. I couldn't remember when we voted. Okay.
Yeah. Lynn, you had a question?
Yeah. Just
Can you come up and use the mic? That'd be great, so people at home can hear you.
Thank you for
Welcome, Lynn.
Coming.
Working with Kimberly. I'll be reviewing it for the rail yard.
Great.
Piece.
Great.
But the other, since Kevin is here, one of the things I'm doing is working with a bunch of the transfer stations, like 17 transfer stations in Franklin County to deal with. One of the things is under OSHA, we become an OSHA state, so we're now having to do emergency response plans and emergency action plans. So one of the things that I was thinking about, this one section on page 238, the last bullet, I think we should involve the Franklin County Solid Waste District, and you know, they're looking at what to do with debris, you know, the debris management plan, and maybe they don't want to weigh in, but if they do, I would include Jan, at least run that by a temporary storage of contaminated or hazardous flood debris. But the other side of that, I was thinking, when I was writing up these action plans, which I need to run by all the towns, is, and I'm going to run it by the FERCOG, is that when there is an event like this, it's not just the contaminated materials that are going to need a place to go, but it's the transfer stations, right? So, Kevin, I don't know, you've probably thought about this. Like, if there's an event or a flood, and then people have things to throw away. So when I was thinking about how we're going to deal with emergency, you know, getting the transfer station cleaned up, but then I thought they also need to be ready to receive materials that may get damaged in a storm.
Right. Which, unfortunately, I mean, because especially when you start talking about that, you're talking about your wood debris and things like that.
Yep.
You're talking about the houses. You're talking about your white appliances. And presently right now, I want to say when they looked at that, they said we needed a 14 or 15 acres is what they said that was recommendation.
Montague, wow. Right?
Montague is the identified regional
receptive
area, but they have not ever agreed to do it.
Uh-huh.
There's been a problem with our regional management debris plan. That's why I've been talking about this for years.
Right. And what happened was, there was a lot of effort put into that regional plan, and three sites were identified, but then the towns that were the host communities decided not to execute MOUs. So the Regional Emergency Planning Committee, REPC, is circling back to that to see if they
can. We're trying to, for exact same reason. Obviously, in an emergency, we're going to do what we need to do, but.
Yeah.
You're supposed to have in the debris management is one of the few things that you have to plan, pre-plan. And it's very discouraging because every time you turn around, we're being told that we don't have a spot that's eligible, so.
Okay, so what's clear about that? I think what you clarified is that we're not doing it per town, we're trying to do it regionally. Okay, so not just for hazmat, but for like white goods and,
right.
and construction debris and all that.
Right.
Yeah.
Construction debris.
Yeah.
Just regular.
Well, you think, look at the pictures on TV.
Yeah,
if you look at the pictures on TV, you know, after a hurricane or Harvey or whatever.
Devastated. Yeah.
Everybody's yard is full of all the stuff that they're throwing away. Where all that stuff is going, and you have to find a central wherever.
Yeah.
And we, the REPC, has been trying to work on that for a very long time.
Okay.
And we funded money through the Homeland Security, as a matter of fact, because I feel like it's such an issue out there that no one is really solving. So,
yeah, because it becomes then this contamination and vector-borne stuff and all that. I guess just a question I had is, who is on the Hazard Mitigation Planning Committee for town here?
There's Casey, if you can read the... Kevin, there's a list in here, right?
Yeah, so I'm going to get a copy. She's going to email me I've been looking at part of it. Okay, great. Thank you.
I've been hounding her, so it's really... Kimberly, poor Kimberly's been...
She's awesome. Yeah. Thanks, Kimberly.
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
All right, great. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Kimberly, thank you very much for squeezing us in. I know you have an awful lot of people that are renewing at the same time.
Yeah, Well, that's what happens.
Thank you. So, a little late, but Chris Curtis is here for our next appearance.
Can I ask a question?
Oh, yes, please.
As part of Kimberly's notes to me, FEMA's asking that we sign an agreement. It's in your signature file. It's called an ISAA. Kimberly. I'm telling them about the ISAA because we need to have.
I'm sorry, I was like.
Well, it's part of the project, but we got sidetracked. So the ISAA is supposed to be. It's a new thing from FEMA, right?
Yes. So because Deerfield has a repetitive loss structure identified, one of the comments that came back. On the Greenfield plan, which also they have repetitive loss structures from MEMA, was that they wanted to know if it was like a residential structure, commercial, or industrial. And because there was a data breach at FEMA, whenever it happened, they've clamped down on who can see information related to the National Flood Insurance Program, the NFIP. So now you have to fill out this 12-page form. You can't change it at all.
Okay.
If you change it, they'll send it back. So you can add the information that's necessary, but you can't mess around with the language in the paragraphs. You have to send it to FEMA Region 1. They look at it. They send it to headquarters. Headquarters says okay, and then it trickles down. So 4 years from now, we'll get the information. So what I did in the plan was I said, the town of Deerfield has put in a request to FEMA for this information, and the plan will be updated when that information is received. And we just found out about this a month and a half ago. So I filled out the form. You know, put the town of Deerfield in, put the COG in as a data recipient.
That was the third-party data recipient.
I know that we can't afford not to do this, but it is so annoying.
It's very annoying. And, of course, if you read the language, it's, you know, it was drafted by a bunch of lawyers.
Yeah.
But the FEMA staff person said it to me several times, do not change the language.
So can you just give me a... Reader's Digest version of what this is again? So this is sharing information and who's allowed to look at the data?
Yes, exactly. So the town of Deerfield is certifying that you receive the information, the only person you will share it with will be the COG, so we can update your plan, and then you will... I think you have to destroy the information, and then you have to tell FEMA that you've destroyed it.
Okay.
Problem is, it's a public document, and as soon as it walks in the door, it's public.
I know. And FEMA can fight with everyone else about it.
Yeah. I mean,
So there were three towns in Franklin County that had to do this, Leverett, Deerfield, and Greenfield.
That's fine.
Yeah, so we have three people.
So you say we can't, do you mean changing the language on that?
Yeah, just, you can't change any of the language in the paragraphs. Like, you can add people's names like you did, which is fine. But if you don't like one of the paragraphs, I mean, if you, if the town did change it, you'd have to get town council to write a letter and say, this is why we changed the
So the third party paragraph that's on the last page.
Mm-hmm. Just leave that.
Where it is?
Yeah, because that's like if you weren't releasing it to a third party.
I didn't understand that.
You would take that language and substitute it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I make a motion that we authorize Trevor to sign.
Second?
Yeah.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And like I said, when the town does receive the information, we can, you know, I'll just update that page in the plan and say it's a residential structure. We're not going to have any personal or identifying information beyond that because it's, you know, you want to respect people's privacy. Why they need to know that it's a residential or a commercial structure, I don't know. But apparently they do.
Okay. Just one more thing.
Yep.
Anyway, thank you.
You're welcome.
It's not your fault. I'm not blaming you this time.
Thank you so much for coming tonight.
You're welcome.
And all the work. So moving on, thank you, Chris Curtis. Come on up.
Chris, so, thank you. How are you feeling?
Better, thanks.
Good. So this is kind of to review the infrastructure construction services, green parking lot and green infrastructure design services. So I think you had a couple of contracts we were looking over. Is that right?
That's right.
I need to apologize up front. I did look at the email, but what happened was I was looking up other emails earlier for other meetings this morning, and my phone died. So I saw the highlighted red. And it looked like just wicked quick because I knew I was already at 8% left. So I knew I had to look at it.
She means my email back to you.
And so I think I agree to everything. But I really didn't read it that carefully.
We,
so
we had a conversation this afternoon.
Yeah, we'll run through it.
Okay. Yep.
So as you know, we got our fourth round MVP grant. It's a $769,000 project. Of which $572,250 is grant funds, and the rest is local match. And there were six different tasks in that project. Four of them involve hiring engineering consultants, and those are the four things that we're here to present contracts to you about tonight. The other two are things that we'll do essentially in-house with the high school and with the planning board.
Okay.
So the four projects, just to kind of run through what they are, and by the way, I guess I should say from the outset that we got started late on this project. We were expecting the contract in beginning of January.
Yep.
I just got my contract, 10 days ago, so we had about a 6-week delay, and that sort of set us back a bit on the ability to get these things done by June 30th, which is was a tight timetable to begin with,
right.
And now we're on a really accelerated schedule, which is why we wanted to get these things before you tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So the first one, and probably the most complicated one, is we're recommending hiring Ty and Bond to manage the Kelleher Drive culvert replacement project and provide construction services for a total dollar amount of $44,200. This includes doing bidding services, construction administration, construction observation, and record plans.
You don't have the contract. You have the basics because these contracts aren't finalized yet.
I understand. I just wanted to kind of follow along somewhere, and I don't know where to follow along. Am I looking at
right
engineering
here.
Requests?
It's
1-1.
Bidding.
Yep.
Construction administration, construction observation, record plans.
But I'm good.
For a total of 44,200.
You have all of those, Trevor.
Yeah.
I do. I'm starting at, let me just see where I am here.
Okay.
Thank you. Yep. There was something stuck in the middle, so I didn't really. All right. So.
That's the critical one. is what...
So that one, we originally had a timeframe that probably would have brought us into October for the finish, the completion of the construction. When we found out from the state that they were not excited about giving us a contract extension, which we had hoped for, we asked our consultants, Time Bond, to provide an accelerated time schedule for this, and they did that. And I don't know if you have, do they have copies of that?
They have a copy of the accelerated time schedule, yes.
So they...
Is this the one right here?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
Put together a schedule that would hypothetically allow this project to be finished and completed by June 30th, but a lot of things have to fall into place.
Yeah.
And one of the big issues with this project is that there has to be a permitting process that includes U.S. Army Corps of Engineers permits.
Can I just back up on that? Are they absolutely sure there has to be an Army Corps? Because it's not navigable waters. So no. why is there one there? It's what?
It's a feeder.
It's a feeder.
It feeds.
But isn't that waiverable?
Nope.
Not waiverable. Okay.
So what we're...
I have to verify that, though.
What we're hearing is that oftentimes those permits take 4 months just to get that permit alone. We're hoping that we can accelerate that to be done in 90 days under this schedule, and it would then sort of overlap with several of the other project components instead of being done sequentially. So that would enable us to, for example, put the project out to bid while we're still waiting for the permits to come through. So if that works out, great. If it doesn't, we need to have a, you know, sort of an alternative game plan. And the alternative game plan could fall into two options. One is to, once we get to that point in the schedule, press the state again for an extension of, at least we were, you know, feeling that it would be reasonable to ask for the extension of at least 6 weeks, given that they delayed our original contract by that much. We already have a contract with the state, it's important to note this, that runs through June of 2021, because some of our tasks extend into the next year. So they don't actually have to issue a formal amendment to our contract end date. All they have to do is amend our scope, which would seem to be an easier thing to accomplish. And we hope that, you know, that would ultimately be something the state would be flexible about. If they are not, however, the alternative is to expend as much of the state money by June 30th as we can to pay for materials, things like the precast concrete culvert, construction mobilization, things like that can be done in advance, and then use the local cash match to pay for those costs that run over into past the contract end date. There is, I want to identify this, there is a level of risk in that strategy, which is that there is a difference between those costs that would have been paid for by state funds, and you could potentially be on the hook for that.
Right. So the other option is to remove it and apply next year.
Right.
Or the next grant cycle.
But we can't, because it's falling apart. We're lucky if it even makes it through. I mean, really, it's bad shape. I think it's important to risk moving forward, because some money is better than no money, and it's going to happen. And I feel like you can add, you know, Casey and I already called Pat Carnevale. He's the governor's rep.
And what did he say?
He said not to worry about it. He was going to work with us. And I feel like we have a lot of leverage. We, you know, calling.
I just don't understand why they would do this. Why do they give you the ability to do something and tell you you've got to do it in 3 weeks? It's an exaggeration, but it's obviously you can't do a project like that in that kind of time frame with all those needs. So either we ask for something we can't do, or we've, you know, which makes sense because we want to try and get this done, and they've obviously approved it. But then you know, they don't give you the time to do something like that. Why does it all have to be done in a specific time frame? Why can't they give us like a year to do a project? Why does it have to be done by a certain date?
You have to not give up. You have to be persistent. And I mean, Elizabeth Warren's office is, I mean, it's sort of like a Ted Kennedy office in the sense that she does follow up. And Markey has competition this year, so maybe we can even have help from him. We certainly would get help from Jim McGovern. I would get on the hook right away with the Army Corps. Number one, I don't feel like the Bloody Brook is so critical as a feeder that it is not waiverable for the permit itself, or that they can speed it up because it's not really a problematic you know, river course that they have to look at. I mean, come on, it hardly flows, it's filled up. We get complaints all the time. So it's really, I feel like we can pressure the Army Corps to come through. So I mean, I've had really good luck with them over the years. And, you know, I'll call Alan, who helped me out in 2005. He's one of the big wigs now, and I'll find out what he says.
But these things come along like every 6 months or less than that. Why wouldn't we just apply?
Because there's no guarantee that we're going to get funding. And honestly, Trevor, we can't afford to have Kelleher. We can't miss another building season for Kelleher. I mean, construction
season. The
cost
is likely to go up. We'd probably end up being pushed into the next year.
Well, what's
because
the amount of money we're at risk of losing?
The total amount of this particular project is $435,000, including the grant amount is $327,000.
So how much, and so we move ahead with this project, try to get done as much as we can by June 30th. At that point, what are we still at risk of losing? The whole amount of the grant, or?
No, because you're going to spend it. You're going to buy the culvert. Mm-hmm. You're going to do the pre-construction access. You're going to try to do all the most expensive stuff up front.
But do they give you a check right when you do that stuff, or do you have to, they come
this
and see,
is,
oh,
this is all reimbursable.
It's reimbursement it's process.
It's all reimbursable.
But is it reimbursable if you finish the project versus like, right. If they come and say, look, you didn't get this done, we're not giving you any money for this project. That's my fear. Yeah. I mean, you can buy a culvert. I get all that. We can pre-buy all this stuff and have it to the side, and then they come out June 30th and they go, you haven't delivered on this project. It's not complete. We're giving you zero money.
Our sense is, and this is really just an opinion, but we talked to our engineers about this. They said they've had lots of projects like this, and they've always gotten extensions from the state. We talked with Casey and Kevin and Diana today, and all four of us felt like we would recommend going forward, given that the likelihood is that with some pressure, we would get an extension.
We will.
I don't understand why would it be so hard for them to give an extension. I don't understand what the...
Because they don't want it to look like that we're... I mean, part of the issue is why we got money is because we have been delivering.
Right.
And there isn't a regular cycle. Every time the governor gets some money, he puts them out there, and you have to spend it. So this is probably money from some account that was underspent, and he has to get rid of it by June 30th.
Right.
So it's just his accounting, because he doesn't have regular funding source. That's why I went and testified on that S-10 bill, because then it will allow you to have regular funding and a regular funding cycle. And we're not this craziness that we have. I mean, the money, there's more money available next month. But you
can't spend it.
It has to be spent. And it just, you know, it's one of those things, Trevor.
It just seems like a waste of resources, you know, for a government, like that's not how you plan, so, like that. It's just
he's supporting a program that hasn't been supported by funding, a revenue source.
I understand that. I just feel like, you know, that
I know it's
a shotgun approach to getting stuff done. Like, hey, you can have all this money, but it's like Brewster's Millions. You can have $46 million, but you got to spend it all by in 30 days. You run around blowing money all over the place because you just, you know, because you got to get it out the door. It doesn't make any sense.
I know, but that's why we've been getting funding, because we've been able to deliver. So I feel like we have strategies to deliver almost there. And we can add pressure to make sure that we finish it. The most important thing is that we get on top of this permitting.
But my biggest concern is that we wind up on the hook for $400,000. I know we're on the hook anyways. You got to get it done, right? But
well,
I just got to figure out, okay, worst case scenario, where are we pulling $400,000 when we have the thing dug up and, you know, we have to move on this project? I just want to know what the unintended consequences are and how we solve them.
We have money in the capital stabilization fund right now.
It's just all going to, you know, one.
But that's what you're talking about, it collapsing. And people not being able to get to their homes, no emergency vehicles to people's homes for fire or ambulance, and people can't get to work. It is much better to take the risk and move forward on a major access to a whole neighborhood. I mean, this is, Trevor,
I'm not saying it's not worth doing. I want to plan to make sure that we have the money to pay for this stuff and let the public know that we were all excited 3 weeks ago when we all said, we got the grant, we're good to go on this, and what a wonderful job. And then we're going to go, guess what? $400,000 you're spending right away. And we didn't get any of the money. And it's just about setting right expectations for the people and the residents to know what we're getting forced to do.
I think having this discussion is...
It's important.
It is
people
important.
People need to know that you know, you struggle and you fight and you know, you get complaints that we don't get grants,
work.
And we get it, and then you can't even spend it.
It's constant work, Trevor. There is no question. And it's constant trying to...
Why don't we explore the avenues we have that we sat down and discussed this afternoon,
okay,
and then bring you an update back? Because we're not at June 30th yet.
Yes,
we
but Casey, we have to agree to move forward, because we have to sign... We have to make sure that Ty and Pond starts working on this.
I don't think you want to make Ty and Bond wait another week, given
we
the tight time frame that we have.
No, I don't. I mean,
do agree with Casey that we should immediately explore these other alternatives,
and that's
hopefully
what we
get approval so that you have some reassurance within the next couple of weeks, rather than waiting until June.
Right.
That there will be flexibility on the state's part here.
I
would love to have Pat come out, because I met him once.
I just got a quick question, and I think I know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it out loud, that way everybody knows. So going on the theory of we pre-purchase all of this other stuff, we get it done, we can get reimbursed for those things.
Right.
Can you? Or I don't know.
Right.
That was my
yes.
question.
Yes.
So
oh, yeah.
Things
yes.
We can get reimbursed for, so we won't be on the hook.
For the whole amount. That's what my question was.
So we may be, I'm going to throw an arbitrary number out because I have no idea what it is. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows yet. But say after June 30th, we may be on the hook for
half of it.
Number,
or
50 grand.
Or 100 grand, or whatever it might be.
But I don't think...
I just wanted to make sure you weren't on the hook for 100% if you didn't complete everything.
No.
As you do things, as you complete different sections, you can get reimbursements for it.
Correct.
Correct. Am I right,
Chris? I believe
so,
yeah.
Yes.
And I don't think we're talking about leaving the project unfinished in any case.
Well, we would do it. It's just who pays the bill.
Still be able to demonstrate to the
risk
state
that we have
under any circumstances.
Is if we delay this and don't do anything, it collapses, we're on the hook for $1 million.
That's right.
This is part of the argument that we've defined.
You know, it'd be prudent if there's some way we can get a hold of the Army Corps within the next couple of days, mm-hmm. find out what their permitting process is. Yeah. If it's 4 months, then we can go back to the state and say, hey, the Army Corps of Engineers saying, and I'm trying to figure out what is this a feeder to besides the Whately Swamp?
It eventually makes it to the Connecticut River, and the Connecticut River is a navigational.
Yes, but they can come up here and they can see that you can hardly walk through there sometimes.
No, I agree.
I know.
And I don't want to
That's why I think I think we have an argument that it's waiverable, and I think we have an argument that it's an emergency. We are right now, there is consensus. I don't think we have to declare it an emergency, but we are in an emergency situation. So that's part of our minutes right now. We're, right? You agree it's an emergency?
I agree, yeah. If it Dave, fails, you agree? You can't get to the
okay.
people's houses.
Okay, so it's an emergency situation. So you go in and you say, this is my argument. This, we are in a serious situation. We cannot, you know, and it's not like this is a river you have to decide on. It's Bloody Brook. It's trees growing up in the middle of it. Come here and look at it. And then, you know, they'll, I mean, most, if you go and you're like, you just seriously plop down mm-hmm. and you look distressed, and we got this problem. I know. I know. I know. And that's what I mean. I feel like you can't, you have to be persistent, and you have to, and like I said, Elizabeth Warren's, I have found that Elizabeth Warren's office is like the old Ted Kennedy's office, where you got good work, good follow-up. And maybe Markey will be, come through because he's got competition now. So, and then and Jim McGovern has proven to be good too. So, you know, this is how things happen. But the person that Alan, I can never pronounce his last name. It's a huge long last name. He the one that helped me in 2005 on Mill Village, mm-hmm. who was so nice, who I violated, you know, I mean, it was like 113 feet. And he was so nice to me. And, you know, he says he understood what was going on and all that. And he says, you know, whatever. And so I mean, I'll give him a call and I'll say, this is really causing us distress. And you know, maybe he can help us now. He's in out of the New York
sure
district, but it doesn't.
Where we're at.
I know,
and
I know. But
what the financial hit to the town
But the risk
may be.
Is, the risk
I know.
Is.
Bigger if we don't do anything.
If
I get it.
We cannot go until another construction season. We're trying
Kevin,
to get our
could,
work ourselves out Kevin. Of this, Kevin, with the assessments, right?
So, make a long story short, Stillwater Bridge. When we shut down, we had that thing up and running in 26 days, 28 days. I was able to get Army Corps because I showed how bad what our situation was. I got written permission in less than 6 days.
Right.
I think it's worth the lobbying effort without Let's panicking. Let's yeah. follow the process
I do too.
Set up.
You just have to go with your story. And we got emergency situation. We got Bloody Brook that you can hardly walk in. Forget that it's navigable waters.
If you just show that, yeah. showing more of the navigational part of it, yeah, definitely. But show more of public safety.
Critical impacts.
This is critical
absolutely.
Public safety. You have so many homes, you have so many residents, you have this, and this is the potential. And if this happens, these people have no access to their homes. They'll have no access to emergency, which is what I pushed for when we were doing the Stillwater
yeah,
Bridge.
Right.
And that is how.
And that at least you could drive around.
So
this one you can't.
So Carolyn, an important point here is even if they can't give us a waiver, if they can agree to accelerate the permitting process so that it's done in less than 3 months, ideally 2 months would be a better target. We should be able to make this work.
Complete in the construction
like I said,
season,
we're,
correct?
We're already agreeing.
The, yeah.
We are agreeing right now tonight in our minutes that this is an emergency situation.
Yep.
And that we're hoping that we can have consideration from the Army Corps. And that is enough for us to go and build our story and talk to them.
I think that's a great approach.
And okay. Kevin is absolutely right. It's the emergency part that is what's going to give them, is going to bump us to the top for review. And once they have the Bloody Brook, they pull up the Bloody Brook on their GPS, whatever, stuff, they're going to say, what the heck, you know, so...
Do we need a vote on this specific one first or here continue?
So that's the question, Chris. Do you want them to vote to sign this once
yes,
I've
please.
Removed all the draft from it? Because I hadn't gotten that far today
okay.
because we sat and met.
Yeah, that would be ideal if
okay.
we could,
so
if we
Trevor,
could actually sign
what
it.
What to clarify on this particular contract with Time Bond for Kelleher Drive. I have to wordsmith off the watermark.
Okay.
So would the board be amenable to authorizing the chair to sign once that's removed?
Yeah, I'll make that motion.
Do we have a second?
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
What about the other contracts,
Next
Chris?
Contract.
Yeah, so there are two other projects that would be done by EBI consultants. And I have received proposals from them as of this afternoon, so I'm prepared to recommend that we move forward with those two as
These
well.
Both on the other ones.
one's for 20 and one's for 18,000.
That's correct.
Okay. And these are for?
The first one is for construction services to install 8 tree box filters in the town center and 2 rain gardens at Deerfield Elementary School. That's for 20,000.
So can I stop at that one real quick?
Yep.
First? I have not seen where those are going to be yet, and I'm really anxious before I go ahead and approve that to see, or just somebody point out where that is, because it's really important with the work, as you know, the work that I'd like to do downtown. I don't want to put something in and rip it out in 2 weeks, two months, 2 years.
And you'll have an opportunity to review and evaluate those locations. We're waiting for the design plans. Those are supposed to be coming in any day now. I can tell you that there, are you talking about the tree box filters or the rain gardens or both?
Just the tree boxes downtown. I'm good with the school. So, I just want to know where they're going to be downtown.
So there are 4 streets that create that main intersection in the town center. 2 tree box filters are on each of those 4 streets, just to give you a general sense. The specific locations, I can send you a graphic. I unfortunately didn't bring it with me tonight. I can send you a graphic about where those would be located, but those are still negotiable. If you feel an objection to any of them, we can
using Ty and Bond
we can still
to
move those.
Complete streets engineering, and it seems kind of odd that we would hire a different engineering firm to put tree boxes down there.
They're going to coordinate. We've talked to both firms, and they'll coordinate on this. And actually, we're going to be doing a design charrette at our big forum on Saturday.
Yes.
To invite the entire town to come in and talk about this and give their ideas about where landscaping should happen, where pocket parks might happen, where sidewalks and bike lanes ought to be located. And we'll have a full discussion about that.
So there's still flexibility to adjust where those are.
There is, but again, we have this tight time frame, so
it's
not a lot of time, but you do have the ability to take a look at them again.
I'm really nervous about this. I've been very, very concerned that these are going
to go in. Trevor, I have been concerned since the beginning about the coordination between the complete streets, the common, and this mm-hmm. project, and I think we can do it. It can be done.
I mean, it's nice to start seeing something happen, and I'm in all in favor, but I would just be completely embarrassed if we put this thing in and then it's right in the middle of a redesign that we're going to do.
Right.
Well, the bright side is, you know.
I need a bright side.
It's only $750 out of town expense for those, right?
And technically, the boxes are movable.
They are movable.
And they can be replanted.
So, The designer for Ty and Bond, who's working on Complete Streets, his name is Alex Fagnold, has the design plans for the tree box filters in hand now, and we're creating this design charrette with all of that information being presented together. So there is coordination going on.
That was my main concern.
I've been asked to do that. I've been making sure that coordination is happening.
I have been a real witch about that from the beginning. You know
good.
I have.
I know. I'm good. Okay. Moving on.
Makes sense. Okay.
Yep. I have come to your meetings to complain about that, right?
Yep.
I want to just say one more thing about coordination. Just, you know, full disclosure on Deerfield Elementary, the 2 rain gardens. One of them is in the middle of the drop-off circle where people drop off and pick up kids, and one of them is near the parking lot. So we're working on a game plan to install those, one during spring break, so that we don't interrupt, you know, the class problems, and the other one on like June 15th after school finishes, but before the June 30th deadline.
Sure, that's tight. Yeah.
So I've been coordinating with Darius Modesto extensively on this, and he's engaged, just so you know this, that we're not dropping the ball on coordination here.
That's why the contracts are critical. Yep. You got to be able to set these timelines up.
Yeah.
All right.
And Darius, thank you.
So they all need to be wordsmithed with the draft out.
Probably not, but thank you, because it's wonderful that he's been so good.
Yeah, he's been really on board with these projects. So the second EBI contract is a design contract. This is sort of expanding the work of green infrastructure. We would be adding 4 additional tree box filters, and this is just design, not construction. Mm-hmm. So one at the town hall parking lot, 2 at the elementary school, and 1 up at historic Deerfield near the old Deerfield Inn. and then a rain garden also in that same area of historic Deerfield, so there'd be some green infrastructure in that village as well.
That's and, where our vector is for West Nile disease. Mm-hmm. I have heavily concentration of, so
okay.
Sucking up some of the water that's up there is really important.
Mm-hmm. And then there's some nature-based drainage improvements and a new green entryway to the elementary school, which if you know that area, it's pretty pavement-oriented
yes.
right now.
Oh,
they're gonna,
yes, in front. Yes,
they're
going
to try
you.
To design something that's a little greener for that.
And if you, speaking of coordination, Tina, the principal, if you want to touch base with the school committee too, we've been really anxious to kind of get something there. And it really, it sounds kind of funny, but it has, if the design can kind of lend itself to kids lining up in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know it seems weird, but it is like the most critical thing when the kids get dropped off. Kindergarten goes here, first grade, second grade. And so if in that design, if it lended itself to areas for that to happen
right.
in the design work instead of just a sea of pavement, if it was organized in a way, and maybe it can't be, and maybe I'm overthinking this, but
no, that
was something that they had, the teachers and the principal had talked to me about, like, it would be great if the kids, you know, the kind of knew, okay, this is my spot, this is my spot.
Right.
Maybe it can coordinate like that.
That's a really good point, and I'm glad you brought it up, because
yep.
we can still put that into the scope.
Okay.
And I think what's also important is that I know we were trying to do something like permeable pavers kind of thing,
yeah.
but we really need to build in as much as possible, especially for the future going on, so stuff that will not ice up,
yeah.
you know. If we can, because once it gets icy there, it is horrible.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
and then you're tracking in all the salt into the school, and I mean, it's just nasty in the wintertime there, and it
yeah.
would just be so nice if we could come up with something that would be able to have better icing
okay.
something,
I guess.
De-icing something.
Right.
Because it's such a slippery area, and then you salt
yeah.
it to death, and then all that salt goes into the schools, and we're having...
I'm curious what they think.
Yeah.
Those are really good points.
Yeah. Okay.
So that one's $18,000. I think both of those we would be ready to move forward with at
okay.
this point.
Okay. So then, would you be willing to
yeah.
sign to actually do that same vote where...
Yes. So that you can clean these up, get the drafts off,
yep.
and get it done.
Yep. I can have them ready for tomorrow.
Do you want to make a motion?
I'll make that motion that we approve for the design as well.
Both EBI contracts?
Both EBI contracts, one for 20, one for 18.
Okay. One for 20 and one for 18 to EBI.
I'll second it.
Any further discussion, questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Great.
And Casey, I need to get you the updated scopes for those. So I'll get you those by tomorrow morning
okay.
as well. And I want to incorporate the comments that we just got.
Okay.
Okay.
Great.
What about the one for 55,000?
Yeah, I was just coming
did
to
I
that
miss,
one.
I was going to say, did I miss that?
That's the fourth one. So the fourth one is another tie-in bond project. It's for two green parking lots, and it's a design contract again. So
yep.
we don't have the stress of the, you know, trying to get construction done, but we do have the June 30th deadline. We should be able to meet that. So these are the parking lots at Frontier High School.
Yep.
Which are both parking lots, both sides of the high
front
school.
Net, yep.
And it does include some rain gardens within the parking lot and a reconfiguration of sort of the traffic flow and so forth. And the second one is the Leary lot in the town center,
right.
which we've suggested that they should expand beyond the addition,
correct.
The existing
yep.
Terrain. That we need to define a little bit more clearly, but
I'd love to work with you guys on that.
Oh, good.
To try to yeah. lay that out.
Once we get the survey back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that would be really great. Yeah, and tie in some rain garden and pedestrian traffic to Elm Street.
Oh, yeah.
For that. And, yeah, and then I've got some ideas to get out to the common, too. But
oh, good.
Yep. I'd love to work with you on that.
That sounds great.
Do you have the comments from the Common Committee?
Mm-hmm.
I'll summarize that maybe he could have.
I'm not sure.
I could probably put something together.
Just so that they have all the list. Yeah, or maybe you, Chris, you could meet with the Common Committee just to run through their list, because they have been meeting consistently for a long time. So they have a whole bunch of ideas that we're hoping to pursue. And it only makes sense that we would try to incorporate as much as
tie that into that master plan.
The whole downtown with the complete streets, the common, and everything.
Right.
What people have been talking about. So if this would be really helpful to have them have all the list of what people, you know, seem to be the priority.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I could give you help on that. I'd love to work with you.
That sounds good.
Great.
So this one, I'm still waiting for the proposal from Tyne Bond. I'm expecting that probably by the end of the week.
Yep.
The person that's working on it is doing a lot of other stuff for us right now, too.
Sure,
so
sure, understood.
There's a lot of people, you know, helping.
So do we need to
do
another?
So what do you want on this one, Chris?
A similar.
It's Alex.
What do you want for a vote from the select board on this?
Same as we've done.
To authorize an approval.
Once it's completed?
Once we receive a proposal.
Okay. So that would be a request for the select board to vote for you to sign once we receive the completed documentation.
You'll update them all.
Yep.
Okay.
So why is the town of Deerfield paying for Frontier Regional's parking lot?
Oh, that's actually a really good point. I'm glad you brought that up. I've talked again with Darius about this, and he fully expects that Frontier would be asked to pay for their share of the cash match on this, and he's prepared to do so.
Because they have it in their...
Is that in writing?
Well, they've taken the vote. We've already done the, the parking lot is in the large $1.8 million capital project that the town approved. So they're definitely.
So what they were going to do was that they were going to have it done, but by running it through the MVP program,
we can get some of it.
We can get, we don't have to pay. I mean, we pay 50% anyway.
Yeah, I know, but it's just,
so we're not
going to. It's just that.
Yes.
It. Things happening at Frontier. A lot of people are very sensitive in the town.
Yep.
You know,
I agree.
After Deerfield spent $600,000 on a track that's used five times a year, you know, anything that's happening at Frontier, people are very sensitive to.
Mm-hmm. Well, Darius reflected that as well. He said that's why, you know, I fully expect that this will be on our tab for that portion of the cash match. So it'll probably be 50% of the cash match or less, or 65%, whatever we decide it turns out to be.
It'll save us in the long run, for sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's not even to mention the 172 students we're subsidizing at Frontier currently through school choice.
Moving on.
So that's my full list.
So those are his four contracts that he wants to talk to you about.
Okay.
Thank you. So is there a motion to...
I make that motion, please.
Two
for 55,000.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chris.
I'm glad to see you're up and about and feeling better.
Thank you.
We didn't lose you to coronas.
Yeah. So. Oh, don't joke about that.
I'm not joking. This is a serious statement.
I was going to make a bad joke about that, too. we'll see you on Saturday.
Yes. I'll be there.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Take care, Chris.
Kevin.
Thank you.
Kevin, thank you.
All right. I feel like the meeting's just going to start now.
Lots of appearances.
Yes. So we have a couple announcements we wanted to hit on. Obviously, the February 29th, which is Saturday, the Climate Change Forum at Frontier Regional High School. We have a huge group of people and a lot of stuff planned, and I'm very excited to get going on that. So I think everybody's signed up, and we've talked to.
I think we're at capacity on that.
We're at
so.
Capacity, yes.
But we did want to let people know.
But that's exciting. You
it
know,
is.
To be at capacity. That's massive. So that's really fun. We had a meeting on a couple projects update. We had a meeting on the wastewater treatment plant. We met with Waterline Industries, who is doing the clarifier rebuild. So we had our first kickoff meeting at the plant last Friday, and it's really good to meet them and, you know, have them understand all the aspects that are going on. It's an extremely tricky project because we have to, again, coordinate the bypass. We only have one clarifier, and we have to take it out of operation. So we're building up the capacity of the small rectangulars that we used to use 20, 20 years ago, 30
right.
years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So those are getting online, and we're trying to figure out, you know, we have to take that clarifier out of commission and pump out all the water in it and all the sludge in it that hasn't been done in 30 years, just to be able to get exact measurements that can get out back out to the clarifier company who's building the
manufacturer.
Yeah, the manufacturer who's going to build the material. So that was kind of a oh, so that's really hard because you have flow coming in at 500 million gallons. Yeah, 500 million gallons a day. So what do you do with that? You can't just like divert it somewhere. We're going to have to. We're looking at putting it into one of the other irrigation tanks. Since then, talking with Keith, we're probably going to get those rectangular clarifiers up online first and get those and get that into operation, and then we can run that for a few weeks or a week or so and really understand that everything works with that. And then we can, meanwhile, take down that so it's not like a one day off and on kind of thing. We can get that clarifier working.
Good.
And then this is the plan right now, and of course we need buy-in.
It's subject to change as necessary.
Every day. But we think that's the smartest way to do it. We'll know the clarifiers work for when we do the work, and it gives us time to kind of transfer over that. We don't have to spend a ton of money to pump it all out in 24 hours, so we'll have a little bit more time. And
right.
Waterline needs about a week, and that's even tight to get over here and get those measurements. So, but after that, you know, project will sit for about 5 months because it takes 5 months to build that machinery. So it's going to be kind of quiet for 5 months while that happens.
And then
happens.
It'll speed back up when we get to the installation
yeah,
phases.
Yeah, ramp right back up because they're going to get it all done in maybe a month and a half, 2 months. And this is, you know, this is cutting it close. We're going
this
to be
finishing.
This is
a very tight timeline.
Right when it gets cold. So
yep.
If anything happens, it pushes us out. It's going to be tough. And we're in connection with DEP constantly and Dave Kapaska to try and get approval for all these, you know, getting this done at this time frame. So they've been great working with us on all that. So it's tricky, but it's coming around and seems to have a good plan going forward on that. And meanwhile, all the design work is getting underway for the larger project. So in the next month or so, all the bores are going to be happening, all the geotech survey for the, you know, the new clarifier, the headworks building. We did a study on, again, the channel auger versus a bar screen. Keith is going to a couple of different plants. Amherst has one right now, and they've had a hard time with that auger thing because it's been broken down and out of commission for 3 months at a time, and it's been very difficult for them to do. So they did a comparison. We feel the bar screen's probably the way to go on that. So that'll probably get in. That most likely will go into the design, but all of those meetings are still, you know, a ways out as he designs that stuff and we get going and ramping up that project. And I know Barb and Brenda have talked with USDA, and they're pretty yep. comfortable with what they're going to need, and we will be borrowing all the money up front, which is, I kind of wish you didn't have to, but that's the rules of the game. But that's, you know, a year out or so. We don't have to do that right now. So but once we get to construction, they're going to want to see all the money ready. We got to spend our $250 first, then we start on the loan, and then once that's done, we close the loan and we get the grant money to finish up, and then
they help us in the tail end of that to close
yes.
everything out.
Yep. And then we meanwhile we're gearing up to take a look at Old Deerfield, because we can't lose sight that plant is in worse shape than the South Deerfield plant. So so we're working on meetings to get
I felt really comfortable with the contractor that
yeah
the
I did too. Oh, he knows the stuff. Yeah.
Yep. They really seem like they would be in and out. And,
yep.
you know, the couple of questions that I had, I felt like he answered really well.
Mm-hmm.
And so I
yeah.
was comfortable.
Yeah.
Again, the most important thing is communication.
Yep.
And that didn't seem to be that they were going to have an issue with it.
Right.
And so I think we're going to be fine.
And he's a great safety record, a lot of safety
right.
concerns. And
The main thing, again, is that they have to do the measurements. We've got to make sure the clarifier, the temporary clarifier is going to work.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, nothing's going to happen for 5 months while they're, you know, right, fabricating the clarifier.
Yep.
So, yeah, you know, so, yeah, we just hope we'll sit tight and mm-hmm. hopefully that we'll have good weather. And,
Yes, and I can't stress this enough. If anyone's listening, please do not throw stuff down the toilet. No wipes or whatever.
No dental floss.
It is going to be critical that we have a clean as we can while we're doing this project. It's I can't stress enough how much you really need to educate the kids, educate the parents, educate everybody. We'll try to do the best we can with the nonprofits as well, and everybody just kind of, and everybody in Deerfield to kind of make sure that you're on your best behavior so we can make sure that we don't have a catastrophe. And if we get Irene right in the middle of this, I don't know what we're going to do. So it's going to be tough, but we'll tackle it. So that's that project. Did you want to talk about capital planning at all? We had our meeting the other night and went over capital projects.
So the capital planning, and this is actually Carolyn, I had added this so that we could officially recognize that capital planning has voted on their capital plan and submitted it to the select board.
Yep.
They've requested that the select board meet with them on the 11th. So I have that scheduled as the first appearance.
Okay.
Did you want to talk about those?
Were we going to meet earlier or later?
Oh, I've got a school committee that night.
Oh, okay.
That's the public hearing for the budget for the school at 6.
On the 11th?
Yep.
Well,
then you guys can meet without me.
No. What we normally do, Trevor, is we go over there
first and then come back.
So we need to post that night over there for 6 o'clock.
I'm sure capital's going to want, finance is going to, they're all going
to
go.
Yeah. So we have to reschedule the capital and, you know, for like 7:15.
Yeah.
So start the meeting at 7:15 here.
Yeah.
You know what? How about say 7:30? Because you got to get back over
right
here. If they're doing it for 6, then that 7:30 should be more than enough time to come back over here for the public hearing.
Also been asked to have energy. The energy committee wants to come in and discuss their projects as well. So that's going to have to go after CIPC.
Yep.
So 8-ish. I'll have to let MA know.
Yeah.
Let her know 8 o'clock, maybe on the 11th, or we can push them off to the 25th.
See, here's the problem. Their deadline is the 26th.
Oh, geez, yeah.
They're going to have to go with what we can do because
just tell them
we really need to hear what they're talking about for projects and stuff. It's a good opportunity for you to talk to them.
17th?
Can we meet the 17th?
St. Patty's Day? Got corned beef and hash coming.
No. It's a boiled dinner. Corned beef and hash is after for leftovers.
I said I'm on a McDaniel too. I should know this.
I was going to say.
It's an adopted name. I can't help it. So.
My wife's name is Lipinski, and she knows it.
Better get to work.
Of course, mother's name was McGuan. So.
I'd rather not meet that day. But
okay. I'm just saying I can meet the.
Well, how about we limit the rest of the items on the agenda for the 11th?
Yeah.
Okay.
If
how does
that
sound?
Yeah.
Two appearances and anything that's critical that has to happen.
Yep.
Yeah.
Do that? Okay.
Yeah. Then we're not here for that hugely long.
Okay. So, you know, looking at the capital plan, I was at the meeting last night. There's a couple things
they presented to finance committee last night.
They did.
So,
and
Monday night, just for clarification, sorry.
And you know, the senior center church feasibility study we've been asking for a while because we need to figure out what's going on. We need to understand what we need for a senior center, not where it's going, not can it fit in the building, not can it be like in the church or the other building or what we're going to do with those buildings. We just need to know an imaginary building, how much square footage we need, what programs they're going to use in it. How many people will it serve? Will it, you know, gain more people? There's a lot to think about that. And we've been asking for that. And the seniors have been demanding that we get moving on this, and it's been tabled by the committee, and...
I think the reason, this is just my opinion. I think they would be open to having us come back with a dollar amount that, instead of just throwing out 50,000, finish up what's happening now and then come back.
What we spoke about the other night was to maybe garner the services of the man who came to do that.
Yes.
Presentations on
I feel investing into
the state might be working with them as well on our other projects. So
well, I'm hoping that we could get
maybe.
What I was hoping is that we would find out on the in that by this meeting that we would, you know, the housing meeting on the 16th, April 16th, we would be hearing in March sometime what they were thinking for us. And we gave them the name, and I'm hoping that they'll contact them. And and they'll start the design process with them.
Mm-hmm.
Or we agree that we want to pursue it with them. And then we don't have to, we would leverage some money, but not have to pay for the whole thing.
Right.
And we're moving forward in really what we want with that person.
So because maybe we can get a budget and meeting with that guy and see what
and we can amend this. We can amend this between now and the town meeting.
Okay, that's fine. That's really good.
If we don't have, but Trevor, if we don't have any dollar amount,
mm-hmm.
my impression is that everyone would be open when we come back with the correct dollar amount because everybody really liked that man.
It was
in New Hampshire, Keene somewhere or something. Yep. But he seemed he was just right on.
Mm-hmm.
And so anyway,
all right.
I think we've already decided who
circle
we would
back
like.
To that.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
But just throwing out some money, I think, was problematic.
So the only, the problem with the plan as it sits right now, it's like $2,770,000. So mm-hmm. we've got to figure out what we can and can't do. Now, I know $1,547,000 is the wastewater treatment project. That's really coming out of other funds and loan and stuff.
Right.
So, and then we have culvert replacement of $500,000 here. I don't know if that's Kelleher Drive.
That's actually, again, it's misconception on the, it's, we figured that we're gonna have at least $500,000 worth of culvert replacement, of which 400 would be covered on the MVP.
So we have to decide.
So there's really some funding sources that are sort of,
right.
I think, could
if
be massaged. At least identified.
Identifies.
We got to find a way to kind of really get to what this bottom line is that we're going to be asking for.
I think Diana can be helpful with that. We've been
That'd
discussing
be
it.
I know she's been building that.
Yeah, she was working on building a spreadsheet that showed those different funding sources.
You know, so I'm just going to, you know, I might be unpopular here, but the Ford F-150 truck for $32,500, we just bought a truck last year, and we brought it forward, and I didn't think we were buying another truck this year. So I don't know. I just need to be convinced on that. Because do you not remember that? We bought one last year, and
I know
there might be a need for one. I'm just saying...
I think we should have asked Kevin about that.
I know,
that.
I forgot. Yeah. And I just
why don't we circle back? We'll I can circle back around.
I just want to make sure, like, can we do another, can that get pushed off of you? I know that, like, there wasn't going to be any need to buy anything last year, but we pulled that truck up because the other one was in bad shape. And there was something like that where we were going to get reprieve a little bit. And I just don't know if that's ultimately has to happen or not.
Well, I think
we have to cut.
Why don't we ask first?
He's asking for the wrong truck.
Okay.
You know,
I don't know that.
He's, from my understanding, he's looking for a two-wheel drive with an extended cab. Better gas mileage, theoretically, but you know, this is a highway to garage. Mm-hmm. All our cruisers are four-wheel drive now.
Why so that's why I say a little bit of clarification.
Circle back on that stuff.
Yeah. Okay.
Why don't we circle back around to that?
Even if it's a 150, you know.
Yeah.
Well, I don't want to tell him how to run his operation, let's ask.
If needed.
Yeah.
Where the two-wheel drive, the only thing it does is cruise around town looking at the roads, doing nothing.
Well, that's what I mean. I think we need to hear his.
In good weather.
Yeah, in good weather.
Let's hear his.
So let's circle back around to that one.
We know the mower gets paid for, so that is what it is. The mini excavator got pushed off, but we've had discussion tonight on that. So the church thing, so the complete streets, we already have 40,000. I know we have this set aside. That may pare back a little bit if we can't. You know, I'd love to get this stuff going, and I'm like the last person that wants to cut it, but we're still sitting on 40 that we haven't done anything with, so.
But what's the accelerator? And so this is a vision question.
Mm-hmm.
What do you have for, and this is actually a question that I'm asking you as a group.
Yep.
And it could tie into the 350th, which is coming up. What's your vision of what things should look like? Before you answer that question, the question, I'm throwing it out there rhetorically so you can think about it. And then we circle back around to it because it does have an effect on your budget.
Yep.
So
I can tell you my vision. I'm still yet to sit with an engineer to be able to sketch it.
Right. And so that's the reason I'm asking all three of you is because to some extent, by the time you take this to town meeting, it needs to be a vision that all of you can agree on as a select board. So that's why I was thinking if I throw it out there, all scream at me in the background, but come back to me when we can talk about some of this stuff. And Capital is planning to present, so that gives you a week or two sort of think about how you might want to see something change.
I've been talking with landscape architects and people, and I think fairly soon I'll be able to have a.
And you each have some ideas, so give yourself a little time.
And then an idea for the bigger stuff. And I really need to get with Ty and Bond because they've been doing the other stuff. And we've got to circle back to DOT, you know? A lot of work there.
And so that's got an impact. That's why I want to ask all three of you because it really needs to come from you as a group.
We've started a good conversation with DOT.
Yep.
Again, you go and you have your story. We want to participate in the Complete Streets program. We've been trying for years. We have a community buy-in for years. People have been coming to the meetings. This is what we'd like to do. And then you make it happen. You just have to.
Well, that's the case.
You have to have a good story.
But that argument needs to come from all of you. So that's why we need to give you guys some time to hash this through with Capital.
All of us are here.
We're pretty good.
I know.
Anything that looks better is fine with me. I mean, I'm not going to stand in the way of any improvement.
The police circuit, the mobile data terminals, I know they need to upgrade the cruisers.
Yep.
It's a big chunk of money. The data migration, does it all have to happen in 1 year?
No, actually, it happens over a couple of years, I think. Isn't that a couple year thing?
See, this is why I think
if we get with John and say, what are we doing here? I'd like to know.
I think he's presented it to Capital, and Capital can give you. If you have an offline question, let me know and I can ask him.
Okay.
Yeah. I have that information.
And then we pushed off the recreational facility, or they had tabled that.
Mm-hmm.
I get it. We're not ready. So. The generator, you know, we went round and round the other night with this thing again.
Oh, God. I'm so sick of that.
I'll get in touch with Darius and kind of we'll circle back with Casey and we'll figure out what we're doing there.
It must be an awful big generator.
Well,
it's got to run an entire school system.
It has to be 100K, and it has to be three phase, and that's why it costs money.
All the systems?
Yeah.
Well,
but,
no,
Trevor, I think you will find if those
according to Bruce.
Freeze.
Bruce St. Peter's
had more than 2 weeks.
That's some information.
You're going to know where to put the kids. Like,
yeah, for more. It's very disruptive.
I know it's rare, but it happens.
I know.
The good news is when you guys have a chance to talk to Capital, they can give you their thoughts on that. And so the intent in giving you the plan is to follow the bylaw, make sure that it gets to you in a certain amount of time, and we scheduled the meeting as quickly as we could to have the two groups sit down and go over it line by line if necessary. But I think you'll get some feedback from the representation on Capital planning.
Okay. So the
on the 11th.
The restroom floors at the elementary school makes sense. The restrooms. I went to the. I was there for a meeting the other day. Walked through the bathroom. Looked great. They did the first bathroom, which is the public ones. When you come in, the new dividers
wonderful.
Are up.
Yeah.
The floor has been redone, epoxied. It looks really good. There's still, you know, stuff that needs to get done, but But it, what a difference. And then I looked at all the others are in really bad shape. So I'm glad that they're doing that as they can. And the gym floor is awesome. I talked to the custodians over there last night, and they said the gym floor is perfect. It really, really came out nice, and they have money down the road to refinish that and keep it up to date. And then the flooring they do every year, which is makes sense. And then we have capital stabilization at 250, which that's what they would recommend, but we just don't know if we'll have that kind of money to put in there. So
Trevor, the records thing is only 1 year. What it is, I was thinking of last year's. The department switched to a new regional records database 2 years ago. 21 years of prior records are still housed on an internal server. With the record retention laws, it only makes sense to have all the old records rolled in with the new, brand new servers.
Mm-hmm.
This will allow us to discontinue the current servers in the police department, which will save the town money from upgrading and maintaining them.
When, so, do you have the other, the police cruiser stuff too?
Yes.
Just wondering what that's.
This will allow for current 7 mobile data terminals. They're used in police vehicles. They are Panasonic Toughbook laptop computers. These computers are specific to police, fire, and military needs, as they have heated hard drives, backlit keyboards, and hard drives that are mounted on a spring suspension, etc. This is anticipated since we purchased the last set in 2013. You will note is a capital replacement schedule for 6 years already, and we are approaching year 7.
Okay.
So.
All right. Just wanted to know what that was about.
So. Yep.
Okay. So.
I think
is that
was,
it for capital?
Yep.
Do you have any?
Have we looked at the issue of caller ID with the police department phones?
Not yet, because we have to get a chain. John and I have to discuss whether they can do that or not.
Yeah, because that should be on his capital plan.
Yeah,
we have to figure that. The thing is, before we put it on a capital plan, we got to figure out whether that can be done. Because as we said, as we mentioned when you came in, POTS lines haven't been upgraded by Verizon, and even when I was here before, the entire time I was here, they told us unequivocally that we could not get caller ID with our old phone system lines. So it's something that John has to make a decision about how he wants to handle that, and he and I have not talked about that. We have a meeting, so I'm hoping to bend his ear on our way.
Okay.
So.
And he will call hold me of that now that he's heard it.
Yeah.
So then moving on, we've got microbrading regulations. Board of Health agent has requested.
So he's actually requested body art regulations. Misterm it, so I apologize.
That's fine. Yep. So you're going to put together a meeting for in the future.
So what I talked to the Board of Health agent about was when you do a regulation, you generally have to do a hearing date
mm-hmm.
with a presentation of the draft regulations. He gave me draft regulations. I'm still wordsmithing them, formatting them, really.
Yep.
But I need the timeline from him so that we can set the information process in place, because those publications have timelines.
Yeah.
I do not have that information, so what I suggested to the Board of Health agent was that we set, that the Select Board of Health set a hearing date for the 25th of March at 6:15. That should give us enough time to do.
Can you say that again?
It's March 25th. It's a Wednesday on your regular schedule
okay.
at 6:15. That should give us enough time.
Okay.
Great. No, it's wonderful. I've been trying to get these done since last summer.
The individual may want to come in on the 11th and talk to us. But
Dick might want to come in anyway.
Okay.
Before that, but we only have that one meeting before that.
Right.
This is for the regulation, so it's going to be an open meeting. If whoever is I don't know anything about that part, but they're definitely as part of the open meeting, welcome to attend.
Yep.
So I'm sure Dick will convey that.
Okay.
So the next agenda, the next item is the consent agenda, which consists of SCEMS appointments. I do want to read those because I think it's always good to do that. But the This would also be the project management designation, which would be our town administrators for approval and signature of the grants, right, that you're...
It's an identification, so they know who I am.
Perfect. We have a special liquor license for the Jeep night at Damn Yankees on March 7th from 5 to 9. And then the recreational committee had a resignation, so we'll accept that. I'll read that. And then on May 30th, 2020, there's a road race request to benefit the Franklin County Bar Association's Community Fund Scholarship Account. So I think he's in touch with the chief on that, probably.
Yes.
And,
yes.
You know, I just also wanted to mention that May 16th would be the fun fair in the Deerfield Mile. So kids will be running around for that. And I think the police is going to get involved, and hopefully the fire department again, and do all that. The 2020 census boundary validation program, this is the town's legal boundary for signature, so.
We're confirming it prior to the 2020 census.
Okay, great. So I just wanted to read, so honorable board, I respectfully request that the following per diem appointments be made for South County EMS. These appointments are for three respected providers who represent all points in the emergency medical path, medical career path. I just want to read these. It's good to know who's, you know, who's taking care of you when you dial 911. So Samuel Broder is a longtime paramedic with significant experience. He is returning to pre-hospital care after a short break to attend medical school, and he now holds the position of emergency medicine resident physician at Bay State Medical Center in Springfield. Not only will Dr. Broder bring an incredible amount of knowledge to South County EMS, his appointment will open up new opportunities for cooperation and to provide expanded services to our community. His compensation will be the standard EMT paramedic per diem rate, grade 4, step 2 of $22.85 an hour. Robert W. Swayze recently earned his EMT basic certification and is currently a full-time firefighter EMT for the South Deerfield Fire District. Mr. Swayze has previously been riding and mentoring with South County EMS to develop his EMT skills, and he now has that he is certified, we welcome him to our roster. We look forward to working together to increase the number of highly trained responders at the ready. His compensation will be the standard EMT basic per diem of grade 2, step 1, $16.23 an hour. And Ahad Yildiz is a local resident and a recent graduate of the Greenfield EMT basic program. Mr. Yildiz has been aggressively chasing his dreams of working in public safety, not only through his experience in high school, learning from the Deerfield Police School Resource Officer, but also through a self-directed firefighter training after joining the South Deerfield Fire District. Mr. Yildiz looks to further his training and his dedication to his community by joining the ranks of South County EMS. His compensation will be the standard EMT basic per diem rate of grade 2, step 1 of $16.23 an hour. So
how wonderful.
Yeah, I just want to thank those people and thank Zach for doing a wonderful job at South County EMS. It's just an amazing organization. It grows constantly, and if you saw, they've got their chase vehicle lettered up. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that yet. I know he's still got to get the lights switched over and stuff. And
the what?
The lights, I think, because he inherited the cruiser and. It looks really awesome, so I can't wait for him to post some social media that, because it looks really good. So I take a motion to appoint those three individuals.
I make that motion.
I'll second it.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
So thank you all for serving our community. And then I think so that's everything. I'll take a motion to sign the to approve to the consent agenda and all the items listed.
Okay. The only question I have is there a certificate of insurance that came with the one-day liquor license?
I didn't put it in the.
Okay.
It really shouldn't necessarily be published as a. As an.
Oh.
Okay. Well.
So do you want?
Yeah,
to
we did get it. It. Okay. We did get it. I just didn't.
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. I'll make that motion.
I wasn't sure it would be.
That's what you need.
Appropriate.
Yeah.
Motion. To take care of everything.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, so,
okay.
It's just.
My bad.
I'll second.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So old business, we have none at the moment. New business, schedule budget review meeting. That's the South County, since the Select Board and the CIPC. And you
We have already scheduled that one.
Yep.
But you guys should really sit down and look at your budget, so.
Yes.
we
so
should.
What do you got? What do we want to do?
Well, it probably should be an off day. The problem is we've got some schedule things. So, and for some reason, because of my email, I cannot do a doodle poll. John, if you're listening. So we don't have to do it right this second.
Well, just
but,
let us know what you pick. That's fine. Work with,
I don't.
I can get here most of the time. So okay. Work with day schedule
just,
and whatever
yeah.
you can fit. We'll come in.
I just want to.
As soon as you can. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because we need to get moving. Finance is finishing up, and they're wondering where the select board is with everything. So.
I think.
Do you want to do it after the 11th?
No, before. Because they need their that.
So when do you want to?
I think they're really interested. I mean, we've done Kevin's budgets
for the most part.
We'll hit back on that a little bit, but
well, we're going to have to get together.
We need inspections in our office.
Yeah.
So I'm good with that anytime.
Yeah, I mean that can be.
I would like a little time to think about the administrative arm of it.
Okay.
As it
because
it may be that we coordinate a little bit, but the other ones we could do.
Get back to us when you.
Do you
want to
do it next week?
I'll do it whenever you're ready.
What do you guys have for next week?
I'm available the 3rd next week.
That
the Frontiers budget
is,
presentation.
What
that is also the election day.
Oh yeah, yeah.
We don't want to do that.
So and I got school committee on Wednesday.
Wait, when's Frontiers? I didn't see anything on Frontier.
Yeah, Frontiers budget's at 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock on the 3rd?
I believe so. I could go look at the posting up there, but I'm almost positive.
Oh, man.
Positive.
I didn't even know about that.
Almost positive.
Unless and Kevin reminds me that
something
we have to go over wastewater treatment plant. I had spoken to Brenda about it on Monday and today, and really wasn't in a... She really wasn't ready to give it to us yet, so... We should probably see if we have enough time to... That may be one that waits a little bit longer, but it is out there.
Well, I don't know if you want to just look...
Can we just...
Let us know.
All right.
Do
you want me to do that?
Can you confirm the Frontier budget presentation for next week? Trevor thinks it's Tuesday at 6 o'clock. I just want to make sure that we all three of us know about it. And that you post it for us.
Oh, so you want a meeting posted. All right.
Well,
I'm going to have
because,
to figure it out.
You know, because we might... I mean, I want to go. I mean, that's a huge percentage of our...
Yeah, budget. We used to go when I was here before.
I mean, I always go, so...
My list is...
I just didn't know about it. I mean, no, I didn't hear about it.
Make sure
it.
I get this right for
it. No, you're probably right. I'm just saying, I just want it confirmed and
March
that we post it.
Okay.
3rd... wait a second. No, yeah. Deerfield is on the 11th, but Frontier is on the 3rd at 6 p.m.
Okay.
Oh, it is.
So
yeah.
Just, can
do
you
want
post?
Me to send you an email and post?
Post it.
Actually, I'll post it and confirm it with an email to you guys.
Okay.
Of
thank
the posting.
You. Yeah. I don't want us to get, not, have us show up and not be able to
yeah,
say
the
3rd
is definitely there. Yeah. So then you'll let us know on some other meetings. That's
yeah.
fine. And then the Cannabis Control Commission bylaw compliance response, which I think I've read, and this was to let the CCC know that
we've confirmed that they comply with the bylaws
yeah.
and I had the zoning officer confirm that for me.
And this is Suns Mass to make sure that they are all in compliance with
yep.
their zoning bylaws, and they
yep.
are. So I don't know if you need a signature from me tonight.
It's in the blue folder.
In the blue thing, so.
They should be in order. So.
Oh, do you want me to sign this boundary one?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So, have we heard anything from Deerfield Naturals?
I have not, but I hasn't. I'm working on catching all these things up.
Yes, please. I'd love to have you come forward. I know it's just a couple seconds if you guys don't mind.
Well, I mean, it seems like we're, you know, moving ahead on this one.
Yeah,
we're not
where are you
here.
At?
Yeah.
Where are we at? Matt Kaufman, Deerfield Naturals. So we heard back from the state. They wanted a couple check-the-box items before they will dig back into the application. So we have sent those back. That was about 2 weeks ago.
So now we're just waiting again, and hopefully they will review them, and we'll have a professional license soon.
That'd be great. I know you've been.
I'm sorry, that's not much of an update, and I wish it was more.
Two sentences, go with it.
That's all right.
Do you think it's worth reaching out again, Trevor? I don't want to.
Do you think we need to?
Any help that, you know, can be pushed, I would greatly appreciate that.
We're on that.
You know, coming up on a almost a year since we've submitted, so.
Right. You know what? I'll reach out to Steve there. He seems to be pretty nice. So.
That would be great.
All right.
Well, the town of Deerfield started this approval process about 6 years ago. We were one of the first ones.
And we still have yet to get anything.
And we still have not seen anything yet.
Gosh, poor Dick. I made him go to all those meetings. We were gung-ho to make sure that we were not going to get social consumption, but we would be okay with other stuff. And gosh, it didn't really matter. It's terrible.
Did I read something somewhere where the Cannabis Control Commission is contemplating taking over local zoning?
Gosh, I hope not.
I hope not.
I have not heard that.
Okay. It's just where they were going to have control of it instead of the towns.
Can I just say where I spent 3.5 hours of my day?
One sec. Can I just hit these two other things and we're
sure.
done?
Sure. Okay.
So ZBA, request for comments on Talega accessory apartment application.
Trevor had asked for some background.
Yeah.
So I sent it in the packet.
Yeah, and so that
this is actually,
and that was the background from the building commissioner.
Right, that he let's get it.
Should be right before that.
Yep, right before it. So the letter was January 20th. The letter was to serve as a violation notice and a summary of our conversations, both in person and on phone. So that they're regarding a legal apartment being occupied in your accessory building. And so the building apartment, you didn't have any apartment currently occupied. So your property doesn't allow for that. So you're hereby ordered to cease and desist. And the further use of this apartment, I am requesting that the apartment be vacated on or before March 1st. I just don't know where we are on that process, but
They have a hearing in March, and they were asking for any comments that you had. So the application represents the response based on the building commissioner zoning officer's letters.
So they had asked for an extension of time, and he said he was willing to grant another 30 days. This was as of February 6th. You are still ordered to cease and desist the use of the apartment. It must be vacated before April 1st, 2020. So.
See, my understanding of it is the building used to be zoned commercial. Because that's where Bruce St. Peter had his electric company.
Mm-hmm.
Because of non-use, it reverted back to residential.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And at that point in time, when it reverted back, that was a non-complying apartment. Because what they did, mm-hmm. from my understanding, is they converted where Bruce was into an apartment, which was a violation of zoning.
Yes, and we have, letters stating that they're, neighbors are concerned. There's a lot of cars in the driveway, and also had a right-of-way to the driveway, which connects to our property, and I own 10 feet of the property in my building on the north side. Residents or visitors continue to use, although I consistently request the space to be left unused. Posted signs. I mean, to me, they also raise chickens. They roam me. So, I mean, my comments are for them to cease and desist, right? I would support the building inspector.
Your comments are your comments.
Yeah. So my comment.
What are the comments of the board? Is really the question.
My comment, and then you can decide to adopt or amend it. But my comments would be for them to. I would support our building commissioner and the zoning bylaws, and they need to cease and desist and
no, you
and,
even and say that you just
go
say
through don't the, even say that. Just say,
yeah,
you know,
just say can, that you support the building inspector
building
and our zoning bylaws, our current
my,
bylaws.
My comments have been amended, so. I support no. the building
Guess what? You can write up. I can't reach, so you write up.
No, you.
Do you have a space
have
for me
good
to write?
Comments. You said.
Actually,
you
can write it right on that comment sheet. That right.
Oh, here we go.
Support, yeah. And you support our current zoning. I mean, you just leave it at that.
The Are we taking
oh,
a
we.
Vote on that, ladies and gentlemen?
You can't really what? Get into a lot.
So after he writes it, are you going to take a vote on it?
Yeah.
I think our administrator is saying, yes, we are taking a vote on it.
I make a motion.
Yeah, I'll second it. I think it's just a matter of him going to the zoning board and getting approval for the apartment, which they'll probably give. Because you've got the building right next to it that has four apartments, and the building in front has two.
Yeah.
So it's...
Well, this is an opportunity to know what the other committees are doing. So these types of requests,
yeah.
It gives everyone a chance to sort of understand mm-hmm. what the work is in the other committees.
Yep. Well, I mean, we have zoning.
Right.
You,
and the zoning officer, that's his job is
right.
to interpret.
And you support yeah. the zoning. Yeah.
We support our local building commissioner and his actions in this matter at this time, and the resident needs to follow the process for remediation. Or
relief.
Sounds good.
There we go. So everyone seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Welcome.
I know it's, well, I guess it's under new business now.
Well.
We supported the addition on North Street, or without objection, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
I don't understand.
Come to find out, he's not adding on to the south end of the building. He's adding on to the west side of the building, coming right out to the road.
But that was not what the plan showed.
No.
Right. So I think, yeah.
So it's...
That we no longer support the...
No.
I don't know. Do we have a chance to comment on that again, or do
well,
we take that comment
it's
to
going
the
to
zoning?
Well, it's going to the ZBA.
Okay.
They will probably request a comment.
All right.
They'll send out a comment
yeah.
request. It, based on what I've seen in the last couple of weeks, they will probably do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
If I remember, I can ask Bernie.
And we, you know, just on the topic, I just wanted to voice our support for the zoning board and all help they need in any other matters. So
I'm working
whatever we can do to support
the chair.
Them, I know you're doing that. So thank you for that. Well,
thank you for supporting.
Hmm. Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Because it is
It's
hard.
A lot of work for them, and it's
right.
difficult, and they need, you know, all
and
the support
and
training.
And it's not easy work
weekend.
Either.
Oh, it's not. Yeah. So the Select Board annual town report.
Guess what? You guys need to write one.
Yeah. I'll do that again. I don't mind doing that again. but I'll bring it to you guys for comments.
That's what I was going to say, is if you've got a draft,
yeah.
maybe in time for... I know we're getting really short. We're going to start getting
yeah.
short on time.
Yep,
so
I'll get it done.
What would be great is if we,
thank you.
Even
I'll
if we just send it, if we send it out and reference it for comment on yep. an agenda.
Yep. Okay.
Certainly, I wouldn't. If you send it to me, I will make sure everybody gets
yeah,
it out
I'll
so
do
that,
that
we don't have any issues.
I'll do that again.
Thank you. I just there's so much stuff going on. I just,
yeah.
Honestly.
No, I know. Yep.
I'm out straight.
I'll do same kind of format I did last year. So, and then. So, well, there was. I just wanted to hit one other thing here, and then you have the town administrator's report if you wanted to say anything. But the items unanticipated 48 hours prior to time of the posting was the FCECS contract. And that
so
was
that's the radio contract.
This is the radio contract.
And that incorporated all those changes. Carolyn's aware of it because
yep.
she was
yes.
at the meetings.
And
that incorporated the changes that the state requested prior to the transition to the COMIR system. And when we were going through files, we found it.
I contacted the COG. It doesn't seem like we did.
And they couldn't give me an answer today. So my question was,
would you
vote for Trevor to sign it so that we can get it out there? Even if we find out later,
at least
we'll have processed it.
At least we know that we processed it. Yep. So this is, yeah, for the, all the emergency radio stuff and all the negotiations they did on that, so.
Yep, I make a motion to approve that.
I'll second it.
I know we did it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I talked to Rebecca and she wasn't able to figure it out at that point, so.
It's fine.
I figured the worst that happens is people yell at me later.
I'll leave the date open for now, let you fill that in.
Okay.
Okay. No, I guess I won't leave it open.
That's okay, you can put it in.
So used to.
The worst that's gonna happen is Linda's gonna yell at me.
That's fine.
After somebody else does.
I can sign it again if you need, so.
That's right.
All right, so all your signatures are done. And then, you have comments that you wanted to talk about where you were today and what you've been doing?
Well, what's happening is I co-chair the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition, which is all our boards of health in the county. And we have set up a joint information system. We will be meeting, we've already met twice, but we met 3.5 hours again today. And we're going to set up regular Thursdays from now on at 1:30 every week. And if we have to, we'll make it more frequent. We're monitoring the situation. We're going to have every Friday now. We met today, but by meeting Thursdays and setting up every Thursday, we'll have new information for websites.
And what is this about?
This is about the virus. That's circulating,
coronavirus.
Okay. And so we have really great team that we put together to monitor all the different sources. And we're going to put out the information on our website, the links that people can go to. We will have short messages that we're going to update. The main thing is right now, there's no real risk for you in the United States right now.
Except for the flu. So please wash your hands and
follow
those needs.
What you can do is practice your hygiene. This is really basic, whether it's a flu, a cold, or the coronavirus, is that you need to wash your hands for the length of the birthday song, which is about 20 seconds. And you need to practice not touching your face. And you need to, at some point, we can talk about, you know, people need to stay home if they're sick. But right now, it's just hand washing. Things you can do is just think about how do you cut down some of your public exposure if you have to, like going to the grocery store. So buy toilet paper. Buy toilet paper and kitty litter a little bit extra. Make sure you have dog food a little bit extra. So you can avoid like going to the grocery store or just going out in general. So there isn't anything at this point that people have to do, but you just be thinking about the things that you use during the day, all day long, and just
wipe them down.
And make sure you wipe them down. And then do you have enough if we had to stay home for a little while? And we will keep you updated.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, mm-hmm. I talked to Lisa a bit. I was on the call today with DPH as well. They were talking budget stuff more than anything, but
it's
definitely keep involved with that stuff. And you know, it's going to be, you know, if it gets disruptive as it is in China and Italy and all over, I mean, it's inevitable that it will come here. But just please protect yourself. It's just the, you know, it's going to wreak havoc on the economy.
Well, what's really important is, for what the Chinese did, is they gave us time. We have time to be thinking about this and preparing. Mm-hmm. And so you just need to think about what you would do. And mm-hmm. there's no reason not to, you know, worry about it excessively at this point. But
No. You
need to be able to think about, just like you would if you had an ice storm coming. You know, do you have enough stuff in your house to stay home for a little while?
Yeah.
We're talking about just trying to stay home and limit public exposure if we have to. Isolation is not necessarily the correct thing, but limiting public exposure could be the proper thing to do.
Yeah.
So we'll keep everybody updated.
Get more info from you. Yep.
I have a full bar, so I'm all set.
Well, Dave, you want to make sure you have at least a 90-day supply.
I do.
You've got a full bar. You've got a full bar.
That's good.
Currently, I have 120-something bottles.
Do you want any? I thought you meant full bar of soap. You were good to go.
No, he means a full bar.
Full bar. Full bar. All right. I got you. Yes. I got you.
I use a Dove body wash, not bar soap.
Trevor drinks Diet Coke. Oh, no, regular Coke.
Yes, I do.
And like me, Diet Coke. When we go out, we're not very wild.
So we're not going to take an executive session tonight, I don't think.
No,
we had it on there just in case.
I had it on there just in case.
Do you have any updates you want to talk about?
I have one thing I want to ask you.
Okay, please.
I have lots of updates, and I'm trying to write them down, but it's being slow going, so just bear with me. I did have a conversation with Rebecca Boyd up at the COG today, and she wondered, I had talked to you offline about this, but the alternate representative for the COG.
Oh, yes.
Who is that? And
right.
I would like to be that if nobody objects, because there's some activities up there that I'd like to continue. Now, it means that we would have to make sure that we're not intersecting in terms of council meetings, but
did you want to?
It also allows you to have backup.
Well, that's the thing.
You can both go to do stuff.
Only one of us can vote.
But only one person votes.
So you just
votes.
Have to make sure that they're aware of that. Hmm.
So the most important thing is to have representation. So
right.
Don't
and
even worry about
I will
worry
take your lead on this. If you want to take one seat versus I'm happy to stay home one night. So
The thing is, I've spent a long time. The last 4 years, I've been representing Ashfield up there, and so I found it very educational.
I love it.
It is an added meeting for me. I get that, but
No, I know.
The information sharing is very helpful.
And networking is beneficial.
Yeah,
so
it's been very helpful. I but it's an alternate thing, so I just wanted to ask you about it while Rebecca and I were talking.
If you want to take the lead, I'm fine. I could be an alternate or whatever you want to do. I'm totally
well,
fine.
First you would have to appoint me as the alternate, and then we work out the schedule.
I make a motion to appoint Casey as the alternate, and I appreciate the fact that you are interested enough to go. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
To the FERCOG, yes.
For the FERCOG, yes.
I'll second that. Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And I'll let
Rebecca
know.
Just let me know how you want to handle meetings or whatever.
Yeah.
I'm good with any of that. So.
There are updates to things, but what I'm trying to do is put it together in a written report. I just got it started because what I'm doing is just pulling all these projects into some sort of organized
Well, one thing I
list.
Wanted to kind of say, you know, in public was, I'd be happy for you to close the door for a while and then just, you know, get some time. We
Quiet
talked
time.
About this a little bit, but, and for the public to know that it's an immense amount of work for Casey to be doing. And if you can limit your exposure, I mean, you're always welcome to come in and make an appointment, but make an appointment
set
if you want to see.
Set up meetings with me. That's
set
the
up a
easiest
meeting.
Thing
just
to do.
If you come
set
and
up
plop
a time.
Down, it's really hard for her to get her work done, and there's an immense amount of work to be done, and you've got people to hire and that kind of thing. So just respect her time.
I'm going to be plopping down tomorrow morning.
Yeah, but we've got a system. I give you an update. 20 minutes
there
later,
you go.
You're gone.
You're out. So, yeah, but
we're
just,
on it.
You know, if we're so happy you're here and doing your good work, and we want to make sure.
And I've had a lot of help from Diana.
Yes, I'm glad.
And what I'm trying to do is get together. She's working on a transition plan that's fleshed out to the point where we can, in the office, pick things up when she's moving along. So,
right. That's great.
But I did want to let you know that we've been working on that. Yep. So she's working pretty hard on that, and I appreciate all her help.
Oh, I know. I think she's been happy to kind of get some files ordered in order and that kind of thing.
We're sort of organizing it all so she can step away.
Well, that's the thing. I wanted you to have that time to do that and then whatever you need from there. Mm-hmm. But just,
it seems like the board has been supportive of that. So I just want to thank you all for that as well.
Yep. I just want you to have your time as well and not get bombarded constantly. So, as we know, will happen. Anything else?
Yeah, I just wish to.
Oh, you're not.
Say happy birthday to our town
administrator
today. I was hoping he would not open his mouth.
Oh man, Casey, I'm really
sorry. I'm getting old.
Okay, it goes in the phone. So
Casey,
don't do that.
Casey,
just call Pat. She
knows.
Out
the door before 9 this morning, and I barely made it here
it's
tonight.
It's fine.
And I cannot believe
that's
I
why
forgot.
My phone keeps going off. Everybody's calling me.
Everybody
because they know it's the last year
now.
Before level 5.
You
they're
know
all
what?
Picking on me.
I drove
I'm with you.
I was drove
so you're by.
Yep. I admit I'm older than 39.
I was driving by Bittersweet two or three times today, and each time I was thinking, oh, I got to stop and get you a cupcake. And I was like, oh, I'll get it on the way by again. And every time I was like gunning to get here, and I completely forgot this.
But
last
thank you
time.
For the thought. That was sweet of you, Carolyn.
I am so sorry.
That's nice.
So, yes, I'm old. That's fine.
I'm glad you celebrated with us today.
Well, everybody here, I do have to say, we used to do this when I was here, is we would do birthday cakes for people. And when I left for Ashfield, they don't do that. Oh, so that was totally a highlight of my day because, you know, each department sort of organizes that, and we all really appreciate a birthday cake occasionally. So it's thanks to everybody for helping out with that today.
Yeah. Oh, Scott, okay. I'm really sorry.
No, don't worry about it.
I got upset. I was upset about that vector disease.
Other things in your wheelhouse, dear. It's fine.
I couldn't find it.
Couldn't get straight.
It's the thought that counts, dear.
I'll make a motion weird.